blew the foot peg off a little bit, and I'm just like, well, this sucks. And, man, Devin caught me, and it was just a dogfight that last 7 miles. I look back, and I didn't see yellow, and I'm like, man, it's either Hunter got really dirty, or there's another Yamaha, and I knew Cole was on his white bike, and I'm like, all right, it's either Devin or Glada. Glada usually wears a weird helmet, and I'm like, man, if that's Devin Feehan, that is weird. Like, and I mean, he was all over me and using different lines, and I'm just like, man, I'm just going to be so happy when this is over. And I knew if I could hold him off with about 3/4 of a mile to go, there wasn't anywhere to pass, and unless I made a mistake. And, man, I hit that point, and I was just like, all right, just get to the top of the hill, get across the side here, don't hit any trees, don't do nothing stupid, bring it home for number 7. Win number 67. We tie Bill Balance today in my home state of Ohio. A bunch of friends and family here, and a bunch of friends and family at home that couldn't make it either. But, like, it's always really cool to win these things, but it's also a huge relief. But it's really pleasant to be rewarded for all the hard work and the dedication and the long nights and the long days. And it's tough for sure. And I'm so pumped right now. So thank you, guys.
Devin, man, what a day for you. I mean, you didn't start out in second place. You had to work for it. And man, we saw an amazing pass out there. It got captured on film. You're going to have to watch the replay. But for now, just take me through your race real quick.
Yeah, it was. I had to be patient with this one. Just had to keep the leaders in sight, and rode with Hunter all day, which was really fun. We kept it, you know, nice and close, which is exciting. So, man, just super thankful to get up here again. A lot of hard work. So, got to thank my family and all the sponsors that helped make it happen.
Yeah, Rodney down here with Coltrane himself. He was just telling me a little bit about his race. Cole, man, just tell the camera crew here exactly what you just told me.
Oh, we got off to a good start. You know, this bike's been firing really good. And, you know, we felt really good running behind Walker there. He gapped me a little bit. I felt like we were both a little bit faster on different parts of the track. And then I don't know what happened. Kind of started to lose rear brakes there. I, you know, went to push him and nothing was there. And Hunter and Devin were riding really well, caught up to me. And just couldn't, you know, get the bike pivoted on some lines there. And they got around me and I just made a few mistakes. And then kind of after I pitted, you know, I just tried to ride the rear brakes a little bit and see if they'd come back. They finally came back, and at that point, it was like, I don't know how far back we were, but just kind of slowly and steadily reeled those guys in, and ended up here.
Man, fantastic. I mean, that's a hard day. Job well done. Congratulations. We'll see you up there on the podium, but for now, appreciate your time.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, 7-time GNCC champion Walker Fowler.
The sweet, sweet throw of champagne.
On behalf of your GNCC nation, you are indeed the XC2 Pro-Am 2021 national champion.
Well, I tell you, Ronnie, coming into this one today, I know you're probably carrying a lot of weight on your shoulders and maybe not even realizing that it was about to happen today. Number 1, the 4x4 Pro here at the GBC Fir Oak GNCC. And your early leader is going to be Cody Collier aboard the 823.
But the big news of the day is Landon Wolf. All he has to do is come in second place today. Cody Collier can win as long as Landon Wolf is in second place. There he is, ladies and gentlemen. Right there is a red number one plate. That's Landon Wolf. Big smile. You can see it all the way through the helmet. The win goes to Landon Wolf. You knew, I know that you know this, all you had to do was bring it home in second place and you win the championship. What was going through your mind, though?
Yeah, Cody was riding really well, and I think he even had a little bit of an issue, but I was just chasing him. I knew I just had to get second. I didn't want to make any mistakes that would jeopardize that second place, so I was just kind of riding behind him. He followed a lapper into the fast line, and I was like, what's it hurt? Take the slow line. Lapper slowed down in the fast line. I swung right by him, and the rest was history. So, I wasn't really dying for that first because I knew I just needed that second, but we'll take what we can get.
Oh, for sure, man. Well, you really put it on him there. You really put an exclamation mark on your championship with this race win today. You won by over a minute over second place, so congratulations to you.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together. Caitlin Osborne, Hannah Hunter, and Tracy Pickens. Our WXC podium here at the Burr Oaks GNCC. All right, Bryce Pullen in second place, but Bryce Pullen, because of timing and scoring adjustments, won the overall.
Seconds away from going GNCC Racing as our attention turns the ring, tally up in turn number one.
Becca Sheets. Becca, last time around your home track, what better way to go out than with a win here today at the Borough?
Yeah, it's awesome. This is the very first GNCC that I ever tried back in 2011, and this is the last time I'll probably race on this property, and so I knew it was going to be a little special weekend, and it didn't really matter where I finished, but I was, obviously I wanted to win, and I just put it together today. The dirt was so good, and my suspension was working really awesome, and you just kind of had to figure out the track, and it got better as the time went on because all the bike ruts got developed. We pushed through the dozer tracks and through the old quad ruts, and the track got better, and so I was just able to flow better by the time, I don't know, the third lap came around, and I just really had fun out there.
WXC winner, wearing the number one plate aboard the Yamaha from right down the road here in Ohio. One more time. Ohio, are you ready to go? GNCC racing! Second, and row number one, the XC1 Pro will be off and rolling at the GBC Borough GNCC. Around the first turn, Trevor Bollinger. Big time takes the whole shot. It's the number three of Jordan Ashburn in second.
So we had Johnny Girard and Mike Rakowski already through. We are told by our spotters and our producer.
Greg DeLong is through, as you said.
There. Greg DeLong just came through there in third. And Rudy Barbosa, here he comes on that Phoenix Racing Honda out of Chile. There's Baylor getting fuel. Here is Ben Kelly in. Are they? Oh, they're just kicking it. They're not going to change it. They're just going to kick it.
There it is, coming into the final two turns, and it is win number 8 in this 2021 championship season as he takes over the points lead here at the Burr Oak GNCC. Points leader, what do you think about... One more question. Were you doing math in your head on the last lap, or were you just focused on winning that race?
I mean, I knew if I won, it was the white plate. But you know, it's just another day. Like I think a lot of these guys put too much pressure on themselves. I've been there. I've done that. You know, the last thing I want to do is say that's a life-changing event if I get this championship or not. It's what it is. I love racing. If I'm second and he wins, I'll still be happy. I'll still be riding my dirt bike, and I'll have a smile on my face. So, you know, I try not to think about it too much.
Well, there you go, folks. A smile on his face either way, but that smile may be just a little bit bigger right now with the win, and we'll get with our second-place finisher, Ben Kelly, in just a moment. We saw a lot of aggression out of you early in the race. You were up there pushing for the lead. And then we kind of saw some hand motions. We saw an extended pit stop. We saw some, kicking to get some things straightened out. Tell us what was going on there, and what was your mindset at that point as you're watching the top guys kind of ride away from you?
Yeah, honestly, I'm just pretty mad about today. Had a good jump off the line and pushed my way right into first early. I was aggressive and did everything right, but had a crash kind of like a mile later, dropped back to third, and is frustrating because... I don't know, I work so hard, and that's happened to me like 3 times. I feel like I've given it up this year, just stupid things happening, and I can't do that if I want to be a champion, so just mad at myself, but it's not over. I'm not worried, I'm just mad at myself, so 2 more races, and I'm going to try to get the win there. I'm sick of Stu beating me and Shobo not there. I want to rub it in his face and get those wins, but hats off to him and everyone else out there. You know, everyone's riding good.
Jordan, we always say the politically correct answers, but I'm going to ask you the hard-hitting question. How bad do you want to win?
Pretty dang bad. You know, it's just frustrating because I led a lot today, most of the day, and I felt really comfortable all day. And then just a few mistakes back there in the pin section, and they slipped away, and they really wicked it up the last couple laps. And, you know, we're just going to keep hunting them and doing our thing.
Another podium today, folks, for Jordan Ashburn. You know he wants that win bad, but he just keeps checking those boxes and getting ever so closer.
All righty. Thanks a lot, Johnny. And, again, congratulations to Jordan Ashburn on his third-place position finish today, as well as his stellar ride. And that guy right there, Stu Baylor, amazing ride for him as well, digging deep, as they all had to today to put themselves in the position they were in. But comes out on top, a one-point lead. As far as this championship points race is concerned, 2 more races to go before this one is in the history book.
Finally, it's Sunday. GNCC Racing is back in action for round number 12. This time, coming to you from Newburg, West Virginia for the Buckwheat 100. There's not much more we can say about what's going on here in the world of XC1 bike action. If you know, you know. Ben Kelly trails Stu Baylor by just 1 point. A heavyweight title bout that could come down to the final round. Kelly needs a win. Stu wants a 6-point lead headed to Crawfordsville. Who's it going to be? There are championships on the line on today's edition of GNCC Racing, and you can catch it all next, live on Racer TV.
I have to say Ben Kelly. I don't want to get beat by old Ken Belly. Not today. Not the rest of the year. Got so much I need to cover.
I'm sick of Stu beating me and Showbone out there. I want to rub it in his face and get those wins.
And welcome to America's premier off-road racing championship, the 2021 GNCC Series presented by Specialized, an AMA national championship. I'm Rodney Tom, along with Mikey Waynes, and Johnny Gallagher will be along as well. And today the stage is set for another historic battle of, the championship as far as GNCC is concerned. We've never seen it coming down to like what it is right now. 1 point separating these two championship contenders with only two rounds of racing left to go right now. Stu Baylor just taking the points lead one race ago at the Burr Oak GNCC, and Ben Kelly right there in the hunt and thick of things, finishing second right behind him, but falls 1 point behind in the championship. And put this into perspective, Stu Baylor started out two races behind, with two races to go, he's 1 point ahead. The cool thing about this is we take a look at this Specialized race recap. We got to see a good look at the Intimidator. Trevor Bowles are getting a great start there. In that first lap or so, we got to see a great ride out of him and what he's capable of doing and kind of what we expect to see him maybe already be doing, but he's still coming back from injury and the surgeries and so forth. So next year, I think this right now might be a good glimpse of what we're looking for Nick from him.
Yeah, you got to feel good if you're Trevor Bullinger. There's nothing but good takeaways from that last race for him with the start that he had and what's in store for him. Some good things, I think, for him in 2022.
And, of course, as the race wore on, it came down to exactly what everybody was hoping for. Of course, you had Ben Kelly, Stu Baylor out front battling. You had also Jordan Ashburn, who was once again throwing his hat into the ring. And the guys aren't mad at Ben Kelly right here because he isn't going fast enough. Ben had a little bit of an incident, got that front end jacked up. They actually got it straightened up just enough that Ben was able to put on quite a bit of a charge there.
Yeah, that's frustrating for Ben Kelly, certainly with what he's got at stake for the season. He's been very candid about the pressure he's felt in himself from the team and everybody around him. He's carried that points lead for the majority of this season. But that man right there, Stu Baylor, he's got it as we head into this weekend, and it is setting up for a wild last two rounds of GNCC.
So Baylor does it again, takes another win here in the 2021 championship season. As we said, that puts him into 1 point of the lead as far as the bid is concerned for the title. The first champion we're going to have, new champion I should say, in nearly a decade.
Yeah.
Whenever you put the names together like that, Caleb Russell with eight of them straight. Ben Kelly, man, pushing so very, very hard. He seems a little bit disappointed. I don't know. It's got to be tough right now. Ben's in a pretty tough spot whenever you take a look at that. He finished second behind Stu, which gave Stu the points lead. Jordan Ashburn consistently once again in the number three spot. Ricky Russell gave us another strong ride out there in that fourth place position, and probably the best ride consistently over the course of the race, 3 hours of it this year for that ball right there with that top five finish, I believe.
It's been a solid year in the XC1, and anybody questioning how Stu Baylor would handle that pressure, well, he spent the last few days hanging out with Travis Pastrana. If that tells you how he handles pressure, there you go. He's got ice in his veins.
I love the post that he's got going on. If you follow him, it's certainly been very entertaining. But Stu Baylor with the points lead right now, Ben Kelly in second. As we said, 1 point separating them. Jordan Ashburn, 62 points back in third, but, man, got a really good cushion of about 34 points or so over Josh Strang in fourth. And Josh Toth, there's only 5 points that separate those two riders, so they're battling it out for fourth place. And, I think those guys, it means something to them, so we're going to see them going after each other. Grant Baylor, unfortunately, I believe, still out due to the shoulder injury and surgery that he's having, so he won't be a factor as far as that is concerned. But I tell you, with this penultimate round, the stage is set for a great XC1 class, and this XC2 250 Pro classes,
getting pretty exciting as well. I believe we might be able to see Jonathan Gerard wrap up the championship today whenever you look at the point standing, if everything goes in his favor. Craig DeLong, the defending champion, what a valiant effort. He's had his ups and downs, but, man, consistency has put him right there in the second-place position as far as the second place in points is concerned. He's got a great cushion there, about 30 points out behind Gerard, Witkowski, and Barbosa out of Chile. Only 3 points separating them. And then Lyndon Snodgrass, another foreigner and visitor there in that fifth-place position in the XC2 Pro-Am. So we got some pretty cool stuff going on as far as that is concerned. Jonathan Johnson actually wrapping up the championship in the FMF XC3 125. We saw some great rides out of that. Chase Colville in second. Ben Parsons still recovering at home in Florida, but we've seen good rides up Jake Froman, Jason Lipscomb. Noah Clark also put on a good ride last time, so be looking for some new and exciting things as far as this XC3 125 Pro-Am class is concerned these last two rounds of racing.
It's going to be a wild one. Well, hey, we've talked about the point standings, who's battling who out there. Let's take a look at our Yamaha track description with Jared Bulton to see what we got in store for these guys.
Thanks, guys. Here we are back at the Buckwheat 100. This was a new addition last year, and we thought, hey, everybody liked it so much, let's go back and try it again. Here we are once again, and boy, this one, I know you know what I'm going to say, but I'm going to mix it up this time. There's a little something for everyone dirt-wise. The dirt here is probably the most unique mix we've got all year. There's probably the most perfect, loamy, beautiful dirt I've ever seen in the state of West Virginia, mixed in with some of this black mud. There's even a little bit of sand in places, and guess what? If you like rocks, this place has got those too. The trails here, they're a little bit on the faster side. Nothing wide open except for the field sections. You get down the woods, it's a little twistier, kind of tighter for the quads, medium to fast speed for the bikes. But, like I said, the dirt is the biggest factor here. There's something for everybody when it comes to the dirt. And for me, that loamy brown dirt, oh my goodness. You could cook brownies with that stuff out there, eat it, and everybody would say, hey, that tastes like a pretty good brownie. So the biggest thing here is such a mix. Everybody's going to be having fun, and that's going to lead to some great racing. That championship battle from the bike side, that could get really, really interesting with the conditions we have this weekend. Those guys love this kind of stuff. A good mix, it makes for some great racing. That's this weekend's track description. Back to you guys.
Thanks a lot, Jared. Mikey, I tell you what, it looks like these guys have got a classic GNCC trail there. I mean, one of the old schools. I love the atmosphere here in Preston County. It's so cozy, and the racing, it might get cozy, but it's going to get crazy, I think.
It's going to be a wild one. So much at stake. Stay tuned. We'll get a word from our sponsors, and when we come back, Rodney Tomlin will be down on the starting line with those iconic 10-second calls.
Rocky Mountain ATV MC, retailer, distributor, manufacturer, product developer, parts tester. This is what we do. But who we are is something much simpler. We're riders, like you. 100% employee owned and operated, a company built by riders, entirely for riders. Rocky Mountain ATV MC. Get ready.
The directive: advance human performance beyond biological limitation.
This Racer TV broadcast is brought to you by Specialized. Specialized Turbo E-Bikes. It's you, only faster. And by Rocky Mountain ATV MC. Get ready.
So,
make sure you think about it before you hit it that first lap. That'll take you over to the 6 mile mark. Some really fun trail through there. It'll bring you down to the Monster Mile. You jump out the Monster Mile to the 7. That'll bring you back around here behind the pro pits, or you'll go up to the pro pits. And this will be different too. We're going to just start is so awesome. So when you guys come down here behind the start, you guys are going to make a left, and you guys are going to run the start every lap. So you guys will come up around first turn, second turn, third turn, and you'll tie back in from there. So you guys are about 11 and a half miles at first lap. Just be paying attention, guys. There's a couple changes, and see who hits the whole second lap. Good luck and have fun.
Safety first. GNCC racing, like all motorsports, can be dangerous. Racers, now that you have had an opportunity to inspect the course, have heard the race procedures and a description of the course, if you feel that either you or your machine is not prepared, then now is the time for you to withdraw for a complete refund of your entry fee, no questions asked. It is your responsibility to operate your machine in a safe manner, maintaining control at all times. Extreme caution is required when approaching areas with high concentrations of fans. Do not take unnecessary risks that endanger the safety of fans. You will be penalized for reckless racing. Race fans, due to the nature of GNCC racing, there is no fence barrier around the race course. It is your responsibility to keep yourself and your children a safe distance from the race course. Never turn your back on oncoming racers, and remember, stay off the racetrack. For the safety of everyone, unauthorized drones are prohibited and will be confiscated. Finally, these are challenging times, and we must all do our part to keep ourselves and each other safe from infectious disease. Please maintain a safe 6-foot distance from people you do not live with, and wear a face mask when you cannot social distance. Wash your hands and use hand sanitizer often. Although this may be somewhat inconvenient, it is necessary for your safety. Thank you for your cooperation.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, to ask a blessing on today's race, Mr. Ricky Towery.
Thank you, Rodney. Let's go to the Lord and have a word of prayer together this afternoon. Heavenly Father, once again, we thank you for bringing us all together safely to have a little fun. Lord, you bless us with such a beautiful fall day to go out here and enjoy it. Lord, just watch over these riders and keep them safe. Let them go out there and have a good time together. Once again, we thank you for the landowner for letting us use this piece of property. Continue to bless that family. Lord, continue to watch over our military men and women. They're in all parts of the world watching over so we can be free to come out here and have fun together. Do be with our leaders that they will make the right decision for our country each and every day, and be with our first responders and all the communities throughout the United States, serving and protect us. Lord, you do so many things for us every day that we take for granted. We just thank you for what you do for us and watching over us. Continue to bless us. Lord, we've had so much fun already this weekend. We just ask for a few more hours this afternoon. Take us all home safely when it's over with, so we can get back together again one day. In Christ's name we pray, amen.
Now, if you would, please rise to attention, remove those caps, and cross those hearts as we honor the greatest nation in the world with the playing of our national anthem.
Oh, say, can you see? By the dawn's early light, what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner
Well, there you have it, folks, and the stage is nearly set. One more order of business before we get this show up and rolling, and that is, it's now time to meet our starting lineup. Rolling to the line today in accordance to points to the first 11 rounds of Grand National Cross Country Championship Racing here in 2021. Into round number 12, your brand new points leader with 1 point. Riding aboard the number 514 from Hodges, South Carolina on an Ampro Yamaha, Stu Baylor. Second in points now, aboard the number 530 from Harwinton, Connecticut on an FMF KTM factory machine, Ben Kelly. Rolling to the line today, third in points, riding aboard the number 3 from Livingston, Tennessee on a Magna One Motorsports Husqvarna, Jordan Ashburn. Freshly in just moments ago from out of North Carolina by way of Australia, on board the number 114, a former GNCC champion of the Babbitts Online Monster Energy Team Green Kawasaki, Josh Strang. Riding aboard the number 206 from Winsted, Connecticut on a factory racing FMF KTM, Josh Toth. He is seventh in points, barred the number 212 from Duval, Washington on a Coastal Gas factory racing machine. He's rough, he's rowdy, Ricky Russell. Eighth in points aboard the 989 from Williamstown, West Virginia on a Rockstar Energy factory racing Husqvarna, Bad Thad Duval. He is ninth in points aboard the 739 from Morganton, North Carolina, also on a Rockstar Energy factory Husqvarna, Trevor Bollinger. 10th in points aboard the number 523, your U.S. Sprint Enduro champion from Boonville, North Carolina on an M-Pro Yamaha, Lane Michael. And making his XC1 Pro Racing debut today aboard the number 282 M-Pro Yamaha, Mike Witkowski. And that, ladies and gentlemen, your starting lineup for this, the AMSOIL Buckwheat 100 GNCC. As our riders find their way onto the starting line, the stage is set now, and Ricky Towery will find his way into that first turn region as he will set to conduct our orchestra of starts here in Preston County, West Virginia, the heart of the GNCC racing nation. Ricky right now making the final last radio calls and checks to make sure all systems are go. And it appears it's an okay and a green light from all around the GNCC racing nation. The track is clear, scoring is ready, EMTs are in place, and we are ready to race as Ricky Towery lets these riders know 1 minute, 1 minute before the start of this Buckwheat 100. Ricky Towery bringing out the blue flag, which will signify 30 seconds and a dead engine call across this starting line, setting the stage for today's racing action. As the blue flag comes out, shut them down, guys, shut them down, shut them down, shut them down. We are now less than 30 seconds away from going GNCC racing, and I gotta ask you, are you ready to go GNCC racing? Come on, West Virginia, I heard you a little bit, but I know yesterday you guys really rocked the house, so I'm gonna ask you one more time. Remember, we're in the heart of the GNCC racing nation. So, one more time, are you ready to go GNCC racing? 10 seconds, And row number one, the XC1 Pro, will be off and rolling at the AMSOIL Buckwheat 100 GNCC. Round the first turn, it's the 514 of Stu Baylor leading the field into the house. It is bad. Thad Duvall second now, dropping back to a fourth place position as he gets swallowed by a new second and third place ride to the XC2 250 Pro. Ryder Lafferty, Benjamin Nelko, Cody Barnes, Simon Johnson, Thorne Devlin, Lyndon Snodgrass, Brody Johnson, Brendan Poling, Jesse Ansley, Craig DeLong, Vincent Smith, Sebastian Turvin, Ray Barbosa, also Jonathan Girard, and Jonathan Johnson in 10 seconds. Around the first turn for the XC2 250 Pros. Whoa, it was stolen. Lyndon Snodgrass, I believe, sneaking in and taking the thunder there at the last possible moment. The FMF XC3 125 Pro-Am class. Jeremy Lallement, Noah Clark, Eli Childers, John Wells, Max Fernandez, Zachary Garrels, Jason Lipscomb, Hunter Newirth, Jake Froman, and Michael Piller in 10 seconds. FMF XC3 125 Pro-Am hitting the stripe. It's going to be the 332 of Noah Clark from Ozark, Missouri on a Maryville Power Sports Fast Company Fly Racing Machine. Going to be a contender today as we go to the 258 class. JoJo Cunningham, Will Seibenpiper, Michael DeLosa, Tyler Palmer, also Neil Inman, Zachary Davidson. 10 seconds. Bubs Tasha, Gavin Simon, Bolton Baroth, Alex Luger, Chase Colville, Tanner Collins, Dylan Carano, Joshua Katz, Tristan Landrum, and Trevor Maley. The 199, oh, no, the 334. And that wasn't his GNCC number, but 199, I know, coming off of a displaced shoulder from last weekend. We'll keep an eye on his progress today. Open A class, Dylan Dela Cruz, Tyler Braniff, Ezra Prine, Tyler Soriano, Jason Tino. 10 seconds. Blake Best, Dunstan Vinson, and also Josh Ellis. Tyler Braniff from Terre Alta, West Virginia, RG Motorsports, Dirt Prodigy Off-Road, and Bonsai backed ride. As we go to the 158 class, coming up next, Zach Toth, or Smith, Cole Thorne, Ryan Piper, Sean Myers, Trevor Valentine, Jaden Dahmers, Hunter Smith, also Nathan Delaney, and Caleb Baltimore. 10 seconds. John Myers with a good start. Will he be able to hold on to it? He will. The 421 out of Reimersburg, Pennsylvania, grabbing the early lead in this one as we get to the four-stroke A lights class. Cooper Jones, Trevor Getz, Travis Reynaud, Sam Hall, Matthew Davis, Todd Ely, Mitch Owensby, also Gavin Sievenpiper, Chase Landers, Lucas Hole. 10 seconds. Kevin Weber, Lance Machino, Lane Whitmer, Connor Keegan, Blaston Moore, Jace Knopp, and Jack Joy. .587, Lane Whitmer from Amity, Pennsylvania on a Coastal Husk Barnum, backed by Bicon and Moose Racing, taking the early lead in this one to the senior A40-plus class. Smiling Frank Messina, Shotgun Sean Messina, Larry Sylvia, 10 seconds. Vinny Tomac, also Surly Amancio, Zach Baldridge, Joe Dean, Harley Anderson, Ignacio Lavosa, Darren Darmos, and Jimmy Johnson. Shotgun Sean Remington out of New Salem, PA, and a Moose Racing Dunlop backed ride. He's a coastal racing rider, if you will. And a junior AB 25 plus class coming up next with Grant Marriott, also Austin Franklin, Cordell Clark, Tyler Burton, 10 seconds. Austin Zink, Evan Maynard, Caleb Haynes, Jeremy Houston, Anthony Burbick, Travis Cavas, Van McCarron, David Mushisco, Harrison Schreiner, Aram Moffitt, Jesse Kildo, Andrew Boggs, and Braden Moore. The Vet A 30-plus class now as we go to Joe Marsh, Danny Haftel, Joshua Wyatt, Fabian Barada, Andrew Smith, Mark Koresko, Robert Johnson, Josh Knapp, Joshua Brown, Colin Goodman, James Bauer, Sasha Durjic, also Tom Truxell, and Nate Kronk in 10 seconds. Up next, Vet B 30 plus class with Adam Odell, Larry Hopper, Joseph Reimer, Andrew Lowell, Julio Lubiana, Nick Resch, also David Smith, Nick Plank, Michael Funk, Nathan Dickey, Dustin Moffitt, Brian Restorski, Keith Taylor, Fernando Xavier, Zach Gaines, and Charlie Torrenzi. 10 seconds. /7:22, Brian Reswatarski from Cuyahoga Falls, Ohio, on the factory back KTM, back by Maxis, and Brian Reswatarski. Senior B, 40-plus class, coming up next, Brett Maynard, Jeff Blood, Felipe Branger, Chad Miller. 10 seconds. Adam Nastic, William Hollenbeck, Ray Hinch, Scott Dallin, and Brent Newsom. Senior B, 40-plus. I think that was 403, Adam Nastic from Garfield Heights, Ohio, on an Elyria Fire Department Point View Cycle RMA TV backed ride. 150B coming up next in 10 seconds. Seeing Conry, Peyton Gwynn, Gavin Hampton, Harvey Bull, Blaine Barrier, Nick Barrier, Caden Childers, Aiden Myers, Carter Wendland, and Brady Weimer. .438, I believe that was Aiden Myers from Union Grove, North Carolina, on a Coromoto SR1 suspension backed ride. 10 seconds. 250B class, Ethan Dingle, also Nick Martin, Hayden Serena, Tyler Shields, Dakota Lokowski, Timothy Narbelt, Vincent Villa, Rodrigo Correa, Chandler Taylor, Ty Hughes, Kyle Miller, Landon Beatty, Colton Shields, Brock Belsel, Robert Rosinski, Samuel Goins, Tyler Martin, Andrew Inman. Ty Hughes from Whitfield, Virginia on the Acherbis Dunlop Rhino Powerbacked Yamaha grabbing the early lead in this one today to the Open B class. 10 seconds. Dylan Fleming, Austin Hovetter, Briston Havard, Zach Dennis, Michael Muovich, also Dylan Douglas, John Hawkins, Landon Rogers, Austin Bruni, Jacob Maynard, Joshua Vitale, Ryan Hymick, Michael Horwath, Burke Marsiglia, Matthew McCormick, and Andrew Veit. .214, Austin Hovetter from Arthurdale, West Virginia, basically a hometown boy grabbing the early lead in that one. Four-stroke B lights, Anthony Blackburn, Hayden Schultz, Trevor Golden, Garrett Mundy, Thomas Allen, Levi Elliott, Nick Thomas Thompson. 10 seconds. Max Grant, Rayleigh Messer, Gunnar Yo, Austin Sentinel, Trenton Hole, and Caden Sims. Our final row off the starting line here, the 316 on the machine. We'll try to get an, oh, it's going to change up maybe. .419, Max Grant from Dawsonville, Georgia, on a factory connection, all-terrain power sports, Ken DeBack ride. And that's going to wrap up our starts. Over 200 riders traversing the trails here at the Buckwheat 100 GNCC, and a championship on the line. Your point leader, newly to the game just 2 weeks ago, Stu Baylor, taking off with the early lead. Can he hang on with the point? Can he take the win today? Or Ben Kelly strike back? Stick around to find out. GNCC Live continues after this.
I'm Stuart Baylor. You're watching GNCC Live on RacerTV.com.
Rocky Mountain ATV MC, retailer, distributor, manufacturer, product developer, parts tester. This is what we do. But who we are is something much simpler. We're riders, like you. 100% employee owned and operated, a company built by riders, entirely for riders. Rocky Mountain ATV MC. Get ready.
Directive: advance human performance beyond biological limitation.
Born of family values and a homegrown work ethic, Kometic Gaskets seals your machine so you can focus on the finish line. Kometic Gaskets are the competitive standard for racers who demand the very best. Kometic Gaskets are constructed from superior materials designed to perform in the most demanding environment. Whether it's championships on the line or a day in the dirt with friends, professionals and enthusiasts depend on Kometic. Kometic Gaskets, sealing championships since 1989.
AMSOIL runs on freedom and has since 1972. We changed the industry by formulating the first API-qualified 100% synthetic motor oil. The rest of the market has been trying to follow our lead ever since. But a head start is a head start. We punish our products firsthand in our world-class laboratories and beyond. Because some things can't be learned from a test tube. Run with us.
Last season was my best season ever by far. I won a lot of races, I won a championship, and it was also my first year using ARMA. And one of the things I noticed was just my ability to string good days together. You know, like especially in the summertime in Florida where you're riding every day and the heat index is 108 degrees and you're doing 230s and going to the gym and bicycle and all that stuff. I think in the past I've been super inconsistent day to day. Yeah, I may have a good race here or a good day during the week there, but overall, I think where I improved the most was my consistency in my recovery.
And welcome back to GNCC Live. Mikey Wayne's here, and you've already heard from my colleague Rodney Tomlin down there on the starting line with those iconic 10-second calls. We'll be joined in the booth by Johnny Gallagher here shortly, giving you the race call here at round number 12. Can you believe that? That's right, round number 12, the Buckwheat 100, our second time back here to the Buckwheat 100. Now, keep in mind, last year this was actually our season finale. We had a makeup round after Ironman, and we were here in, November for this one. So this year, round before Ironman, and still so much at stake. And, of course, can't help but acknowledge the fact of what Stu Baylor and Ben Kelly are doing. And I think to get us started, I believe we're going to look at our specialized start recap and get a look. We had some, I won't say friendly wagers, but we were guessing, all right, who's going to get the hole shot? We threw out a lot of names, and the obvious name we didn't throw out was the 514 of Stu Baylor. And we were foolish not to, because he got it and went full send early, getting a really, really good drive right there. And a good lead early in this one was a 514 Ampro Yamaha of Stu Baylor. And Ricky Russell following pretty closely there behind him. Great start out of Trevor Bollinger as well. We'll see more on that in a moment. But, boy, good start for Stu Baylor. If you're Ben Kelly, that is not where you want to see Stu Baylor early in this one. In the XC2, let's go. This one was fun. Lyndon Snodgrass looks like he had it. Then it looked like he didn't have it. And then he said, I want it. Give it to me. And takes it. So the Babbitt's Online Monster Energy Kawasaki rider of Lyndon Snodgrass going out and getting it and taking that early lead there into the woods out of that XC2 class. And then, of course, our FMF XC3, the 125s. As I say, singing the song of our people. You know how it is. Going out and getting a Noah Court. Wants it, the 332 machine. Getting the job done right there. Good early lead for him on the 125. I think that might be, I could be wrong in this, but I think that might have been his first hole shot of the season there out of that. No. Oh, he did last race. Well, there you go, Johnny. Forgive me. I was not here last race, so I get a mulligan on that one.
Hey, when you take a weekend off, things pass you by.
That's right. That's right. So there you go. This is also part of the replay that you're seeing right here. That was Stu Baylor out front, Ricky Russell in the number two spot, and then we were talking about, I believe it's Trevor Bollinger coming up right here. Battling with Jordan Ashburn, kind of missed it through the trees right there, but it looks like that's where Bollinger got the pass. Good start for him, and I believe that was Ben Kelly back in about, what, the fifth-place position, fifth or sixth in there through. I believe that is about, like, the mile 10, mile 11 mile marker?
Yeah, that would have been just before the finish completion of lap number one or the short lap.
Short lap, yeah, the baby lap. Baby lap. Yeah, this is an abbreviated lap. And a matter of fact, if you're looking at live scoring at home and you're saying, hey, they've already completed a lap and it was 7.5 minutes, well, that's because, you know, it's abbreviated. They'll be running this full track. And, Johnny, I'll turn this over to you. I'll let you speak to this a little bit because you were riding this yesterday, albeit different weather conditions.
Yeah, a little bit different weather, but same track, more or less. A couple little bike-only sections, but nothing major today. Starting off at the finish start line, the course heads out through a nice little ridge. There's some good open fields, and then it opens up into, you see from the 1 to the 2 is almost entirely a field section, actually from the 1 to about the 2.25. So that's an incredibly long section out here at CJ Raceway. And then it heads into the winding, slick, rocky woods of the CJ Raceway facility here for the Buckwheat 100. And soon after that, they encounter the power point, work their way to the 3, come down, and as you can see, almost entirely until you come out to the 8-mile marker, it is just woods, tight woods, dark, down in your valleys. You got some hill climbs. There's actually, I don't know if we'll have a shot of it, but there's an afternoon-only XC1, XC2
Ooh.
Only hill climb. Only the I don't know how they ended up labeling it, but I had heard they were going to label it XC1, XC2, XC3 only. And if anyone else tried that hill climb, they would be penalized.
Ooh, boy.
It is that gnarly. I felt like we should have run it yesterday, but I think they were concerned. Originally, I believe that was the plan.
Okay.
But then with all the rain that we got, they decided to save it for today. I think we could have motored right up it, and I think the top XC1 riders will. But that is an interesting section, and that is actually right around the 7-mile marker there that you see. So what you've got there is it's about a half mile around versus going up that hill. So if that comes into play today, and that would bottleneck up, or if someone misses that hill climb,
yeah,
you could see big chunks of time, I mean a minute or more easily, gain or lost in just that one section. So a very dynamic track here, a lot going on.
our second trip here to the Buckwheat 100 here at CJ Raceway. And, man, it's already shaping up to be a great weekend, Mikey. I know yesterday just crazy, crazy action, you know, crazy in our youth so far, and obviously a crazy race this morning in the 10 a.m. race as well.
Yeah, the WXC was a gnarly one. That's another one that, you know, obviously Stu and Ben getting all the attention, but the battle between Becca Sheets and Rachel Archer continues. Patton's going to come down to Ironman in a couple of weeks, and they went back and forth today. Maybe a little prelude to what we'll see this afternoon in the pro bike race.
Yeah, things are really starting to heat up, obviously, in that XC1 championship battle, the overall championship battle between your new points leader, Stu Baylor, and the man who's carried the points lead through most of the season so far, Ben Kelly, having to give up that leader's plate after last round by just, you know, one solitary point. I mean, it's, man, how about it? Like, it's like he worked so hard to have that lead, and he's just knows Stu's back there chipping away at it, and now he's had to give up that plate. And I, you know, Mikey, if I know you weren't with us 2 weeks ago, but watching the interviews after the race, I saw a little chip on Ben Kelly's shoulder.
Yeah, and it's interesting to piggyback off of that. I noticed yesterday, I've not seen Ben do this in the past, but he was there for the micro bikes yesterday watching, and he watched the whole podium with all the micro bikes, and I thought, all right, is Ben changing up something in the routine? Is he like, all right, I want to lay back. I want to see what these kids just enjoying racing that are out there having fun, and I'm going to carry that perspective into today.
You know, and a good angle to look at that from, like Johnny said 2 weeks ago, it was obvious there was a lot of, I don't want to say disgust, but, you know, disappointment, frustration, whatever you want to call it. But, you know, the weight of that point lead, being off his shoulders over the last couple of weeks, it might have changed things up for him, because coming into this race, he was defending that. Now it's a whole little different scenario. He doesn't have the pressure to defend it. Now he has to attack. And that seems to be where oftentimes, I mean, if you watch his racing, his style of racing, he always seems to be from one of those come from behind kind of guys. So this might be a better place for him to be in.
Yeah, you know, there's obviously a catch 22 there of, you know, the more points the better, but they talk about how heavy that reverse leader's plate is, and I think we actually had an opportunity to catch up with Ben and Stu. We might be able to get it in here before they make it to the 10-mile marker.
It's crazy. I guess I'm still new to this GNCC racing game, just in the fact that a lot of these guys have grown up racing this series, and kind of this is what they saw themselves doing. Where for me, I just raced locally, did it for fun, and because it was a place to ride, you know, not much places to ride where I'm from. So we would just go to the races on the weekend, and then started racing GNCC, I guess, in 2016, and now here we are in 2021 and battling for this championship here. So it's definitely crazy, you know. These guys that I'm racing and beating are like guys I look up to, and I have recently, so it's definitely like weird to try to put myself on like a pedestal and just be confident in myself, you know. Sometimes I don't really think I'm as good as I really am, so I just need to work on that honestly and just be confident in myself and know that I should be up front and winning these races. So I guess it's crazy in that sense.
Well, about a 10-second lead is what I counted there, guys, whenever we came through the monster mile here at the coal pile. And Stu Baylor certainly keeping up the pace that he started out with here today, that fever pace right off the as soon as that green flag flew.
I think the first clip we had seen was a flashback there, rapid replay. Look at Josh Toth manualing through there. Josh always has such great style. He isn't quite up as far as he'd like to be at the moment. Maybe he can work his way up through. He's a northeastern guy and obviously rides these kind of tracks well, but definitely pushing the pace early, no question about it. That's Josh Strang. For a minute there, I thought that was a leader of XC2. Now here's a little change right here. This is not the leader of XC2, 282 Mike Witkowski. That is actually an XC1 rider today. He's bumped up to try his hand at the XC1 class right now, chasing Josh Strang. And here is the leader of the XC2 class, and that would be his teammate, or Josh Strang's teammate, Lyndon Snodgrass. So a rare good start for Lyndon Snodgrass. But, Stu's pulling away a little bit out front. Ben Kelly, though, has made two passes since we saw him last, and he's up to third, and he's definitely putting pressure on Ricky Russell for that number two spot.
Got to think if you're Ben Kelly, or Stu, whoever was in that situation, you don't want to let the other guy out of your sights. And Ben Kelly knows that, hey, it's a long race, but it can go quick if he's working from the middle of the pack and he's putting in the work right now. And you can see on screen he's got Stu in his sights.
Yeah, and that 10 seconds has turned now into about 3. Yeah. So it's amazing how that works out. You know, one little section, you pick a bad line, and now these guys are basically pretty much in a battle here. So Ben Kelly and Mikey, I think that'll be the key. A lot of guys will refer that to, I marked this person. You know, he'll say, hey, I marked Stu, or Stu will say, hey, I marked Ben. And it's almost, you get to the point where you really don't care what position you're in,
yeah,
or what anybody else is doing. You just want to know where that guy's at, and you want to be ahead of him.
Makes sense.
Well, I tell you right now, this could end up being a very long day for these three riders out front right here, as they seem to be stretching it out from the rest of the field. And if they can get out and get their own battle going on, this could be very interesting, especially if second place ride there, Ricky Russell, plays a little bit of a spoiler in today's race. And I know Ricky's had some glimpses of greatness these last couple of rounds. And in all honesty, Ricky's about due.
Yeah, I mean, Ricky's had a lot of earlier in the season, especially. I mean, he was right there so many times and just could never quite, you know, seal the deal. Obviously, going back to last year, missed almost the entire season, save for the first 3 rounds before COVID, and had that terrible crash while battling Caleb Russell for a win. So you know he's there. You know he's got the speed. Oh, this is a little change up here. They actually are running into the starting line area now, and they're going to run that. Yesterday, we went straight across the back there, but it's kind of gotten bombed out. So this is how they're getting to back to that same section. They just kind of changed it up a little bit. You can see, so they're right back into the starting line chicanes. So you can see those guys were kind of looking around going, hey, this isn't the track we pedaled. So last minute change there. But all goes off without a hitch. Ricky Russell now back to the rear wheel of Stu Baylor. Ben Kelly falling off maybe just a few seconds there. So
might have been a scenario as Stu is heading back to the starting line, where if you're the guy in first, you're thinking, I don't know about this. I don't want to do something wrong. Now is definitely not the time to get yourself a penalty or docked anything. So Stu might have been a little apprehensive to send it right there. And, hey, opens up the window of opportunity for Ricky Russell.
Yeah, absolutely. Josh Strang on screen, the freight train, the 114 Monster Energy Babbitt's machine, chased there by the 282 Ampro Yamaha.
Is he a dad yet?
Not yet.
Not yet.
Not
okay.
Yet. I asked him just as we were coming over to the starting
line. Or a dad again, I should say.
Yeah. He said no news yet, but it got up at 4 o'clock this morning. He and T-Shep left this morning, North Carolina, at 4 o'clock and drove up here for today's race.
Oh, boy.
Hasn't even looked at the racetrack. So that wasn't a disadvantage at all for Josh Strang right there.
That's, man, coming into this, you know, obviously Josh is a heck of a rider. He's got a lot of speed, a lot of determination, a lot of dedication to even be here, you know, with what he's got going on at home with Baby Watch. There is Johnny Girard. So this is your XC2 points leader. And with the championship on the line, in there looked like they were making some adjustments, and he appears to have fallen back a bit there. See Jesse Ansley behind him, Ben Nelko. So we'll have to see where that takes him, and maybe Mikey Waynes can get us a word on exactly what happened there. Mikey just disappears. He's out of the studio like a rocket.
He wants to know. He's going to get the scoop to see what's going on there.
And there is Johnny. Let's see who that is in front of him. That looks to be Cody Barnes. Mm-hmm. It is. So these are riders, you know, that are typically well within the top 10 in the XC. And there's Rui Barbosa, a rider who was finished 4th place at our last round. So we'll see exactly where that leaves Johnny Girard, but I would say probably still solidly in a, you know, top 7, 8, 9 position somewhere in there. So not anything to panic about. Still plenty of racing left, but definitely lost some time there in the pits.
Definitely get your heart pumping there if you're a Johnny G fan.
Yeah, but while he was there, he made the most of it. He took a drink. Oh, Stu is, look at that, stepping up that little section there. That's a pretty fun little section from yesterday there at the 10. Ricky right behind him, and now Ben Kelly right there. So those three flying in formation, they've opened up a little bit of a gap over these guys coming here, which is Jordan Ashburn right around the podium. Our last two races, our last two rounds since we returned from break, now running in the 4th position. And then it is Thad Duvall in the 5th place spot. So he has gotten around his teammate Trevor Bollinger. There is Lane Michael in the 6th place spot. And there is Trevor Bollinger. That is your top 7 through at the 10-mile marker in the XC1 class.
Well, that second wave of riders could get very interesting. I believe that was that Josh Toth?
Josh Toth running in 8th. And then next should be Josh Strang on the 114 machine, followed by the 282 of Mike Bukowski.
So Witkowski jokingly, I stopped down, didn't jokingly stop down, but I asked him if he had any quotes or anything for me, and all I heard was, help. It actually came, I think, from his dad or one of his pit crews, but it was still kind of funny. But he seemed to be pretty stoked, big smile on his face. He was anticipating the move up to the XC1.
You know, and it's kind of gives us an opportunity to talk about that and how differently these classes race, which is funny because same track, same conditions, nothing different. It would be almost commonplace for Mike, were he racing XC2, to be in the top three, but almost surely in the top five overall on corrected time after one lap. Here he is back running in, so that's Ryder Lafferty leading the way on that Coastal Racing Gas in the XC2 class. And then he has gotten around Lyndon Snodgrass. Lyndon Snodgrass now in second in that XC2 Pro Lights class. But whereas Mike Witkowski, you know, struggling to hang on to the back of that XC1 class, where, again, he probably would have, you know, been almost in the same spot had he started a minute behind. It's just that rhythm. It's that intensity. When you're leading, you're pushing that much harder. You know, now all of a sudden you're racing against guys, like just like what Ben Kelly said, that you've idolized, that you've looked up to, and it's different. So surely he can catch that pace. And so there is Johnny Dreher looking like he's about in that fifth place spot in the XC2 Pro Lights class and well within striking distance of the leaders, you know, the main rider that he needs to keep an eye on for that championship battle would be So with Mike Witkowski, well, Witkowski was out because he had Craig DeLong would be the rider that he's primarily concerned about in that XC2 Pro Lights championship battle, and Craig was just ahead of him probably about 15 seconds. So looks like we're waiting on our leaders here, and they are through. Yep. Ricky Russell's taking over the point position.
Wow, where is Stu Baylor? This is not what Stu was looking for sure. There he is back to third, so not a lot lost, but enough to give Ben Kelly, I think, a little bit of a boost, but as much the 212 of Ricky Russell.
So he's still pretty close, but Ricky Russell now taking the point position. Now he's got to pick lines and pick trail. Now keep in mind, they're coming in and they've already ridden this section of racetrack once. They ran this right off the start, so they're working their way back in for the completion of what we're calling lap number two, but our first full lap of action here at the Buckwheat 100.
Nice flowing racetrack out in the fields, it seems like, Johnny. A nice old school feel in the woods, though, from what I understand, right? All right, Mikey Wayne's down in the pits with a report.
Hey, thanks, guys. Wanted to give you an update on Johnny Dreher. Nothing too serious. He ended up going down there on lap number one. Took a lot of mud on the gloves, so he came in, got him a fresh set of gloves, got him back out and rolling, and like I heard Johnny saying, took full advantage of it, getting a little rehydrated, all that. So nothing major, just a fresh set of gloves. They were actually teasing him. They said, hey, he just got his nails done. He had a manicure. Wanted to make sure they look good out there.
All right. Thanks a lot, Mikey. A good atmosphere, it sounds like, in the pit, so there's no concerns there. That's a good thing.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, he's in a good position with the points, obviously grabbing another win 2 weeks ago at the Burr Oak GNCC, further extending that points lead. You know, and it's he's kind of in the driver's seat in that one, but ultimately, oh, look at that. Boom. Almost had a pass there. Ben Kelly running it up that inside line. Ricky Russell kind of taking the flowy line around the outside. And Stu Baylor charging up that inside line as well there in third, trying to close the gap back to those lead duo. Don't know if he went down, picked a bad line, was in the point position, dropped back to third. And now Jordan Ashburn is kind of closed up a little bit there. So Ashburn really pushing hard. Thad Duvall in fifth, also right there. And Thad had a great ride at our last one. Thought he was going to be in a podium position there. Said he just kind of ran out of steam in the middle of the race and lost those guys, and still ended up a solid top five for Thad.
Yeah, and still, you know, Ricky and Thad, I think, you know, what we're going to see out of these guys out of these last two races are just glimpses of the greatness that we'll see next year. I'm really excited for what the 22 championship is going to bring for us, Johnny, as these guys start to get back up to speed, including Trevor Bollinger. So next season is going to be super exciting. There's not that this season hasn't been, without a doubt, because it has been one that we have been on the edge of our seats for all season long, and one of historic proportions on a lot of different levels as well.
Yeah, you know, and it's very interesting, too, to see, you know, Ricky Russell leading the way on this one, and then the two guys behind him are the two guys that are battling for the championship right now. And we see this quite often. It happens. But it really is, it adds a whole other dynamic because of the point spread, because of the way the points work, and those guys being so close in points. You know, right now I'm sure Ben Kelly just kind of looking at the long term for the race, but if this is the last lap and you're looking and you see Ricky Russell ahead of you, you know, yeah, it's good that you're ahead of Stu, but you want those five bonus points for the win, and this guy's taking them from you. You know, so all these friendships and all the nice stuff goes out the window when these guys are battling for championships. But at the same time, you know, if you're Ricky Russell, you're obviously Josh Toth, you're any of these XC1 guys that are out there battling for themselves, for rides for next year, for bonus money, for points, for their own position, you know, you're not going to just pull over and wave those guys by and say, hey, you guys have at it. You're going to be fighting for your own shot at that win or podium.
Ricky Russell, Ben Kelly, Stu Baylor, 1, 2, and 3. Jordan Ashburn now about 10.5 seconds back in fourth. Thad Duvall not far behind in that fifth place position. Lane Michael running a solid sixth here at the end of the first full lap. Seventh place at 7:39 of the Intimidator himself, Trevor Bollinger. Eighth place, Josh Toth. Josh Strang in ninth. Lyndon Snodgrass back in. Nope, wait a minute. That hasn't updated yet, so they haven't checked in. Mike Witkowski, though, checks in 10th place in the XC1 Pro class as we still wait for XC2 250 Pro. They were up to fourth place, I think, in the overall. I think if it's in yesterday's any indication, we'll probably see him drop back a couple spots now that this race is really starting to set into pace.
Yeah, it's like we talked about. There's, you know, it's when you're the XC1 guys, you're kind of blazing the trail, especially in some of the new sections that the morning race hasn't run. You're having to cut trail, you're picking lines, and as a whole, the XC1 guys are just a little bit more settled. You know, they kind of know more the length of the race. The XC2 guys, it's like, you know, a lot of them, it's almost like a moto. You know, they dropped the flag, and it's almost like they dropped a gate, and they think they've got a, you know, a 20-minute sprint, and they're out there just killing it. And what you find is even the best of shape that you're in, you know, the intensity, the mental focus that it takes to ride that pace, it's nearly impossible, if not impossible, to sprint for 3 hours. I mean, we've seen over the years, these, you know, and you hear Thad, Caleb, you know, Stu, Ben, these guys talk about, you know, I regrouped, I settled myself, and then I really started pushing again. It's just, you can't just go out there and pin in for 3 hours. It won't work.
No, that's a lot of energy to expel. I know that, you know, there's been a lot of science and stuff, and I know that I've talked to individuals that have said your body is designed for about an hour and a half of that that kind of abuse that it receives.
Yeah, well, you have to redesign it then, because these races are 3 hours long.
Right.
We saw the two different lines there, Rodney, and if we recall last year, this was where Ben Kelly actually made the pass on the last lap for two over Stu Baylor to take the to cross the finish line first, and ultimately there was some questions about some lines on the course, and I don't think that there was any official protests filed. It was just a matter of they had determined that a line Ben took was more than 25 feet, and Stu was ultimately awarded the win. But this is where this field section was coming to the finish, and look at this. We got a pass for the lead. Ricky Russell going wide there, and almost looked like he let Ben Kelly go there. And I don't think we were just talking about that. I don't think that's a situation of a championship thing. I think he just maybe wasn't comfortable in the lead and said, hey, Ben seems to have better pace.
Right.
You know, I'm gonna tag on to him and see if, you know, we can pull away from these guys.
Yeah, and, you know, again, that's nothing abnormal. I mean, that happens quite often in GNCC racing, and oftentimes you wonder, what are you thinking when you do that? But, Johnny, there is an advantage to being able to do that.
100%. You know, Rodney, we've talked about it before. It's almost a mental draft. You know, there is no measurable, you know, difference in aerodynamics when you're behind someone, but just the almost not having to think, you just react and do what they do. You run their lines, or you kind of get it to preview their lines almost, and basically if you're, you know, their line looks good, you take it, and if it doesn't work out for them, they're kind of your test dummy, and you take a different one. So
exactly.
It definitely is easier to be in that number 2-3 spot when you're all running nose to tail like that. You lose a lot less energy, it takes a lot less focus, and you know, that's just the
and
truth.
To me, it seems it's easier to be the aggressor than the defender also.
Sure, 100%. You know, when you're out front, it's tough because you're, you know, there's very few guys that can, you know, ride at the front of a race and not let the pressure behind them get to them. because you're just always thinking about the lines you're choosing, the lines they're choosing, are they faster? You know, there's just so many variables that come into play there. And we see Ben actually starting to open up a little bit of a gap over Ricky, but Stu starting to close up that same gap. Stu is going to be very cautious here. He does not want Ben, as we approach the more technical parts of this racetrack, he really does not want to let Ben out of his sight.
Now, if that happens, then that's going to make this a really long day for Stu Baylor, especially running in a third-place position and losing more than the 5 points. I mean, that could be detrimental to his bid for the championship if things go down to a first and second situation when we go into Ironman.
Yeah. Looking at your top 10 on screen there, Rodney, you were correct. The XC2 guys have dropped down a little bit. They have checked in. Ryder Lafferty on that Coastal Racing Gas, a new ride for him. We saw him debut at the Burr Oaks there in ninth place overall, leading the XC2 class, and Lyndon Snodgrass in second.
Ben Kelly now your leader in XC1. Ricky Russell second. Stu Baylor back in the number three spot with Jordan Ashburn and Thad Duval chasing them from fourth and fifth. Still a long way to go. 42 minutes into this race. Who's going to come out on top? Stick around to find out. GNCC Live continues after this.
Even when you're the best, you never stop striving to be better. With over 40 years of experience in motorcycle sales and service, we know racing. Our inventory of Yamaha motorcycles, sport bikes, dirt bikes, ATVs, and side-by-sides is extensive and constantly changing. Stop by LoJack Cycle Sales today in Tarentum, Pennsylvania, and visit our online inventory at www.lojacks.com. Yamaha YZs, it's why we ride.
Hi, my name is Andrea Lee, the director of On Track School. How would you like to go to a school where we take into consideration how students learn best? Well, we do that because we find if we can build the curriculum around the things you are interested in, you're going to do a better job. The mission at On Track School is that educational success is possible while chasing your dreams. Not only will our staff help students to achieve success, they will cheer you on to the finish line. We encourage you to check out On Track School at ontrackschool.com, where we can help you chase your dreams and still get a quality education.
We are American motorcyclists. We are members of the American Motorcyclist Association. Racers, fans, and crew, we come together for this sport we love, to race together, to grow together. We start young and not so young. We race motorcycles and ATVs. We become friends, we become family.
We compete for weekend bragging rights and national championships. We make memories on the toughest off-road courses in the country and on the best motocross tracks in the world. Some of us aspire to the speed and poise of road racing or the fierce competitiveness of American flat track. And we honor our greatest champions in the AMA Motorcycle Hall of Fame. Through it all, we cheer. We win and we lose. We are racing. We are the AMA. Race with us. Be part of the greatest sport in the world. Be an American motorcyclist. Join us today at www.amajoin.com/join-now.
Brown's RV Superstore is family-owned and operated and staked their reputation on offering you the finest RVs available in their McBee, South Carolina RV dealership. Brown's RV Superstore carries motorhomes, fifth wheels, travel trailers, and toy haulers, and keep a huge inventory of new and used RVs in stock for you to choose from. They offer top dollar for your RV trade-in and help you get the RV financing you need. As a part of the GNCC family, Brown's RV Superstore, in partnership with Vengeance Toy Haulers, offers sponsorship packages for every level of racer with discounts and continued savings on your new toy hauler. Brown's RV Superstore has dedicated themselves to complete customer satisfaction, specializing in providing a positive start to your RV adventure. They look forward to customers coming back to share their tales from the road. Call Brown's RV Superstore today at 877-805-3658 or visit their website at brownsrvsuperstore.com, where family fun begins.
And in this corner, wearing the blue, Stu Baylor. I tell you that right there, Baylor versus Kelly. The title fight is on. Welcome back to GNCC Live on RacerTV.com. Rodney Tomlin along with Johnny Gallagher. Mikey Wayne's out and about. And about to get an in-studio guest with former GNCC great Steve Hatch here in just a few moments. But, yeah, that's what everybody's tuning in to watch today, I think, is the fight that's going on right now as we take a look at the action in the on the racetrack. Ben Kelly, at last check, was leading with Ricky Russell in second. Stu Baylor in the number three spot. Stu had led the better part of that first full lap of racing, but somewhere near the last couple of miles, he lost control, lost a little bit of time, and hasn't really been able to gain a whole lot of time, but hasn't lost anymore either.
Yeah, you know, Rodney, this track is this is one of those tracks where you kind of have to take what it'll give you, especially in the woods. It's slick. It's kind of a interesting hard-packed clay here, and with the moisture from the rain that we had throughout the week, and then also yesterday, obviously, we had quite a bit of rain in the morning. If you look out in the sun, you know, where we're kind of standing here in the VP Fuels Pro Row and out around our Racer TV studios, you know, the dirt looks good. It's dry. There's a lot of traction in it. But when you get into the woods, it's an entirely different story. And I can tell you from yesterday, it was like slip sliding around on the ATV and on the bike. I'm sure it's even slicker.
No doubt. And, you know, being here in a tighter woods type race, too, it's a little different than a lot of the traditional GNCC. And word is Stu Baylor up to second, and 4 seconds behind is, well, we'll get the bird's eye view for ourselves as Steve Hatch joins us. And Steve, I tell you, with this championship coming down to the wire like this, you know, there's a lot of excitement in the air and all around, and a lot of nerves and a lot of weight for both these guys as they both try to win this championship.
Yeah, you know what, Rodney and Johnny, it's a battle. It's fun, right, for all of us fans and in the sport. Couldn't plan it any better, you know. Have two races left or a race and a half, and they're battling it out, and both of them want it more than anything. And talking to all the guys, as you guys have, you know, everybody's into it. It's not just one guy, as all three of us know. It's the team and the family and everybody behind it, all the way down to every last bolt on those bikes and every last suspension piece and all the sponsors. So it's pretty cool.
It is very cool. Mikey Wayne's got an update.
Hey, guys, just wanted to give you a quick update on Stu Baylor. Spoke with the guys over there and Pro Yamaha. They said, hey, nothing too major. He went down. Not a horrible spill. He's still in the thing. No bike problems. No problems with Stu. He's going to be right back up there fighting with them. And then they were even lighthearted. They were joking. They said, hey, stir the pot a little bit. Tell him that he waved those guys on because he wants to keep it fun. He wants to keep it interesting. Something tells me he picked up a few things from Travis Pastrana this last week.
Thanks a lot, Mikey. Yeah, Stu Baylor spending the last week with Travis Pastrana. You know, that's kind of odd. going to Pastrana land with a championship on the line like that, but that's just the lightheartedness that you see out of Stu Baylor, trying to keep it lighthearted. But you know, when he showed up to the track today and saw what I saw, that reverse number plate with the white background, the red numbers, you know, that all of a sudden reality struck really hard and really quick, I'm quite sure.
Yeah, and I think to your point, Rodney, I think it's interesting. You know, those guys, they both want to win, and you can't win it in the first race out of 13. You got to win it at the end, and you got to count every race as it comes. And, you know, talking to both of them, they're all battling with stuff every single time and numerous stuff. So for the race fans out there listening in, it's amazing to, as you guys know behind the scenes, what's really going on. There's, you know, 10 to 30 things during a three-hour race. From, you know, whatever, crashing and twisting the bars to shifters ripping off to brake pedals, you name it. So it's just, you know, adversity. So, yeah, it looks like Stu's back in the lead to me.
Wow.
Yeah,
looks like Stu has taken the lead back. Oh, no, that's a
lap. Oh, it's a lap.
It did look like him. Yeah. And I was like, he's coming a little slow.
We do have reports that Stu is up to second place as we wait on our leaders here at the Monster Mile now. I got excited too.
Good gear, right? Looked the same as him with the weight.
You know, Steve, you mentioned, you said, oh, it's fun for all of us. It's fun for the spectators. It's fun for us here in the TV booth. It's, you know, it's fun for everybody. It's absolutely fun for Ben Kelly and Stu Baylor. It's just a little more fun for the guy that wins. And there is Ben Kelly still out front. The KTM guys here in the pits can relax. he is out front.
There's a lot.
Here comes Stu Baylor in second. So just a few seconds behind there as they pound their way through those coal piles, and we'll look back to see where is Ricky Russell, and has their pace carried them away from Ricky? It looks like it has. The pace up front, the top two, we're starting to pull away.
Well, it is what we've all been waiting for, I think. The title fight, you know, when we saw
Jordan Ashburn.
Wow.
Up there.
Yeah. Yep. So not really a surprise there so much. I just expected to see Ricky Russell coming through because, as we know, Jordan Ashburn has been so doggone consistent this year. And knowing this type of terrain, this should be a good fit for his riding style.
Thad Duvall up to fourth. And is that Lane Michael now in fifth? It's hard to tell there, but it kind of looked like Lane. Looked like Lane has worked his way over there. Trevor Bollinger in sixth, so we've lost Ricky Russell. Mm. Ricky Russell was leading just a few miles ago, and now the top seven have come through, and thus far, no Ricky Russell.
So surprisingly, you know, I know if Ben had gotten around and was leading Ricky Russell, the gap, though, is this Ricky coming here now? The gap, though, was kind of surprising to me that it wasn't as large between Stu and Ben as what it was when he was back in third place.
That was Ricky Russell, by the way. So there's Ricky, and there is Josh Toth. So that would be, I believe, 7 and 8 now that have worked their way through in the XC1 class. And we'll start watching for our XC2 leaders. Last we heard, a new, not a new leader, but a rider we haven't seen up front in a few races. Ryder Lafferty on that point position had taken the lead away from the early leader, Lyndon Snodgrass. And here is this Stu? No, they wouldn't be there yet. We're getting all excited.
Lapper, I think.
The riders that have actually won overalls in addition to Caleb Russell doing so on 150, going back to the Shane Watts era, Tommy Norton, you know, those guys. Shane would kind of ride whatever, but preferred the 200 quite often. And a lot has changed since then. The courses are definitely, in my opinion, faster and much rougher than they were back then. So, you know, having that kind of torque, the power of the, you know, 250, 450, 4-stroke brake kind of roll into it, and you're not fighting that kind of snap, the power band, if you will, of the 125, 200 2-stroke, and even the 250 2-stroke. Because, and the other thing is, back then, everyone's riding 250 2-strokes. So and now you see that machine is almost all but gone from GNCC Racing and been pushed out by the, you know, easier to ride, more powerful, more tractable power 4-strokes. So it is a different playing field. So, you know, it's not just saying, well, you know, he's out there on a 125, but a guy like Shane Watts or Caleb Russell has won an overall on that. He really is shooting from kind of a disadvantage, power-wise, tractability-wise. So to see him doing as well as he is,
Eight years of technology.
That always helps.
But a tip of cap to him out there, and you know the fans are loving it for sure.
Totally. Yep. Years ago, we raced both the 250 two-stroke in GNCC, and then we raced the 450 four-stroke out in the work stuff. And it was interesting, the three riders, Rodney Smith, Mike Kudrowski, and myself, we were practicing on the bike that we'd race the next weekend, which made sense to us. And about halfway through the year, we were talking to each other, we're like, in the semi, we're like, hey, What are you riding now? All three of us had changed just to the 250 two-stroke, because once you got to the 450 four-stroke, you were yawning and it was easy and planted and it was boring. But if you could maintain and keep it going straight on the twitchiness and the fastness. So I think you're right to your point, Johnny. I think it's a little heavier, but the amount, especially when you multiply by 3 hours, four-stroke's the way to go.
Sure. It looks like we're waiting on our leaders. Oh, there is the 530 of Ben Kelly. Got a lap rider down there. So we'll see. There has come by. Rodney will get the scoring. Oh, there is Stu just in time. Lap rider picked up his bike. Stu Baylor goes by. So 10 seconds, give or take, 10, 12 seconds between our leader, Ben Kelly, and Stu Baylor. And we do know that they have now opened up a pretty sizable gap over third place, which is no longer Ricky Russell. It is now the Magna One Lubricants Husqvarna of Jordan Ashburn and that very, very familiar bright helmet that we've been picking out the last couple races. And Jordan, man, what a run this guy is on, leading quite a bit of the Mountaineer GNCC just about a month ago, and then 2 weeks ago, you know, leading and battling up front at the Baroque's GNCC, ultimately settling for third in both of those races. But, you know, the prior race at the Mountaineer, battling Ben Kelly down to the final turn for that second place position.
Well, checking in, lap time last time around at 27.32, at 27.39 this time around. Well, 27.32 was what Ricky Russell turned, and it was just a little bit faster for Ben Kelly, but turning at 27.29 this time. Stu Baylor checking in with a 27.31. I think he picked his pace up a little bit. He's now within 10.3 seconds of Ben Kelly and waiting on that third place position. I'm guesstimating somewhere in the neighborhood of 20 seconds is what we'll see on the clock, maybe a little more.
Oh, look at this. We got a battle over that third place position. Just in the rear here of Jordan Ashburn is the 989 of Thad Duvall. The hometown West Virginia boy is on a roll, and he wants himself a podium position here on lap number three, and he is right on the rear wheel of Jordan Ashburn. Folks, we got a barn burner here for third, and Lane Michael just on the rear wheel there of Thad Duvall, so it's a three-rider battle now with Lane Michael, also another West Virginia native, right there, all three of those guys battling over that spot.
Ashburn, Duvall, Michael all in. There is Bollinger, 7.8 seconds back in the number six spot as well. So we've got ourselves a little tight-knit race from third all the way back to sixth place right now, involving four different riders. This is going to be a good one.
You know, and Rodney, this is very reminiscent of what we saw yesterday.
Yeah.
Walker Fowler getting out front, pulling a pretty big lead. But that second through sixth battle and everything I heard about it, Ricky Russell kind of making some head nods there. Don't know if that was crew members, mechanics, fans, maybe his girlfriend who's in town this weekend from Washington State. But he looks like he's okay. He doesn't seem to be injured, and there doesn't seem to be any damage to the machine. But whatever it was a costly mistake that has dropped him out of the battle for the podium for the time being.
So Johnny, you raced it yesterday. Isn't in there the most technical part where he kind of threw it away or not sure?
Yes.
Could have he buried it?
Yeah, absolutely. Stuck. Before where we saw them there at the 7 mile marker, basically from the roughly the four to the that gap is it's kind of coming and going. It seems to be in that 8 to 12 second range, and it seesaws a little bit, but I assure you Stu Baylor's doing everything he can do to try and close that gap, but he's not been able to do it. Flip side of that coin, Ben Kelly's doing everything he can do to not let Stu Baylor close that gap. He doesn't want, again, we talked a little bit earlier, Rodney, about that mental draft of being able to just kind of ride behind somebody. That goes away once you get more than a few seconds, because they're onto the next obstacle, the next corner, so you can't really see their lines, you can't see how their bike's reacting, and you just can't kind of pick up their pace. You know, you're basically in your own little race until you can get to, you know, I think it's different depending on the track and each section of the track, but I usually say if it's more than probably 8 or 10 bike lengths, you're no longer in that mental draft, especially if, you know, if the track is tight and there's a lot of turns, because they're, you know, 2-3 turns ahead of you at that point.
Right.
And adding in, to your point, Johnny, once you're in second, you see them, like, pulling away, you try harder. And like you said when I just jumped on talking with you guys, it's easy to override it and go sideways or just spin.
This is a wide section, Johnny. Talk a little bit about this. Did you guys hit this on the four-wheeler?
We did, and it's pretty gnarly, like, just in terms of how many lines there are and how many ruts there are, but it has a hard bottom. There really wouldn't be any reason why anybody would get stuck, per se, there, but it's such a high-speed section. If you were charging down out of those woods, it is slightly downhill. And if you got cross-rutted, that could be a big, big crash right there. And as I was saying earlier, Rodney, that's actually where we saw the lead change between these two last year on the last lap coming to finish with Ben Kelly just holding it wide through that mud hole and making the pass on Stu Baylor. So, yeah, it's a lot going on here. But to your point earlier, Steve, yes, the section Ricky Russell was, you know, in second. We saw him go in there. Between the 4 and the 7 is the most technical section of the racetrack. That's where all the rocks are. That's where all the really slick one-line stuff is. There's some uphills. There's some ravines. And that is also where that XC1, 2, 3 only line is that's allowing them to climb right up the side of a very, very steep mountain or the long half-mile alternate route around. I can't imagine that Ricky would have gone around and the other guys went up. Anything's possible. And this is one of the things we talked about earlier. You said 10 to 30 things out there they're dealing with. You know, if Ricky's on the podium or even if he's not, we might get that story afterwards. And he might just say, you know, I blanked and I missed that pro hill and I went all the way around and I got passed by 6 guys. I'm not saying that's what happened by any means, but anything could have.
No, I agree. One thing's for sure in these races, nothing's for sure.
Well, I'll tell you what is for sure. These two guys up front are giving it absolutely everything they have and putting on one heck of a show. We're down to the final races. We got 2 to go, one and two-thirds to go now, and these guys are trying to settle this championship. The ding, 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 the prize fight is going, and we are now deep into round 12 of a 13-round fight between these two heavyweights, and they're just still throwing punches.
3 laps is what we're working on right now. Actually working on our 4th lap, but our 3rd complete lap, I guess, would be technically the way that we say it. And again, just a lot of excitement. 10 seconds down to, I counted 8 seconds that last time we saw them. So Baylor, not a lot of ground made up, but you can see he's still trying to charge. But, you know, I'm still saying, you know, we've been talking about Jordan, and, you know, we talk about people that are due, and with the rides that we've seen out of him the last couple of rounds and the aggression that I've seen him riding with there, it wouldn't surprise me to see him start chipping away a little bit at that. Maybe not necessarily challenging these guys, but at least knowing that he's back there, knowing they have someone else to have to contend with.
Well, you know, and the way that battle is right now, you've got, you know, 3 guys that are battling over that podium spot, so they're going to be pushing each other. It's one of those things, and it just kind of plays out differently all the time. Sometimes, depending on the track, when you're battling, you actually hold each other up. Sometimes it pushes you further forward. So that battle for the final podium spot could push them up to the lead, or the 2 lead guys could ride away because of all the internal battling going on. One thing's for sure, Rodney, we'll find out more. It's coming, man. We're down to it. 2 hours left in this one, and it's getting hot in here.
Ben Kelly and Stu Baylor battle for the win as Jordan Ashburn, Thad Duvall, and Lane Michael go at it for the final podium spot. How's this one going to turn out? Stick around to find out. GNCC Live continues after this.
Hi, I'm Ben Kelly, and you're watching GNCC Live on RacerTV.com.
Rocky Mountain ATV MC, retailer, distributor, manufacturer, product developer, parts tester. This is what we do, but who we are is something much simpler. We're riders, like you. 100% employee owned and operated, a company built by riders, entirely for riders. Rocky Mountain ATV MC, get ready.
The directive: advance human performance beyond biological limitation.
Born of family values and a homegrown work ethic, Kometic Gaskets seals your machine so you can focus on the finish line. Kometic Gaskets are the competitive standard for racers who demand the very best. Kometic Gaskets are constructed from superior materials designed to perform in the most demanding environment. Whether it's championships on the line or a day in the dirt with friends, professionals and enthusiasts depend on Kometic. Kometic Gaskets, sealing championships since 1989.
AMSOIL runs on freedom and has since 1972. We changed the industry by formulating the first API-qualified 100% synthetic motor oil. The rest of the market has been trying to follow our lead ever since. But a head start is a head start. We punish our products firsthand in our world-class laboratories and beyond. Because some things can't be learned from a test tube. Run with us.
Last season was my best season ever by far. I won a lot of races. I won the championship, and it was also my first year using Arma. And one of the things I noticed was just my ability to string good days together. You know, like especially in the summertime in Florida, where you're riding every day and the heat index is 108 degrees and you're doing 230s and going to the gym and bicycle and all that stuff. I think in the past I've been super inconsistent day to day. Yeah, I may have a good race here or, you know, a good day during the week there, but overall I think where I improved the most was my consistency in my recovery.
Flip the script, and after I lost my ride, I pretty much had nothing. I mean, the guys kind of left me stranded in mid-season, and then we had some injuries, so that was really tough to break through mentally, personally and physically. I mean, it was tough to come back racing, but on top of that, I felt like I had worked my entire career to get somewhere that was an illusion. Everybody looks at where we are in the spotlight, and I guess physically right now, it looks really cool from the outside. And now we see these teams dropping riders. I think three guys in the last 12 months, and that's sad to see. I mean, we worked so hard for that. So, getting kicked down like that changed my mindset to where it is what it is. Like, I love racing. I enjoy racing, and I'm not going to change that for anybody. I'm done changing me. Like, I'm here for myself. I'm here for my family. I'm here for fun. What we started doing this for. So mindset's the same. And, coming into these races, knowing that you're the guy to beat is dangerous. Like, you can't come here saying, yeah, I'm the guy to beat tomorrow. I'm here for fun. Like, I know what I do when I ride my best, and I know what I'm capable of. But the mindset, I think the biggest thing that I've learned more than anything is not over-pressuring myself coming into these races, having fun, yelling at the crowd when I come by, revving the bike, enjoying what I do. And, for a long time, I felt like the industry and the manufacturers had taken the fun out of it for me personally, and that's kind of where I was. So, after last year, getting kicked down and, they basically took the fun out of racing, I tried to make it fun again, and that's exactly what we're doing. So we're making racing great again.
Well, back here at the Buckwheat 100 in Newburgh, West Virginia, Preston County, you will. There is our tribute to the coal mines and coal miners of West Virginia with the Monster Mile there. Rodney Tomlin along with Johnny Gallagher, Steve Hatch in booth with us as well. Mikey Wayne's out and about. And listening to that interview with Stu and talking about, you know, it made me think about, you know, watching you and Rodney Smith and all the guys during that time, Scott Summers. I mean, there was so much professionalism and everybody walked such a tight line as far as the manufacturers were concerned. And you had those few that came out of the box. You know, one in particular you might think of would be Shane Watts. And then, you know, you had your David Knight. And then, you know, now you've got your Stu Baylor who, you know, I mean, it's almost like he's going completely against the grain of everything that has ever been molded as far as the perfect factory rider. You know what I mean?
Totally. No, great point, Rodney. I think that's a big one. And I kind of was thinking that as he was talking, because as we all know, being in this industry, you dream of the factory ride. We all do. And then when you get it, it's still work. And if you put it 24/7 as work, it takes the fun out of it. And I even remember in my career, especially in the mid to later years, going, nobody said I couldn't have fun while I'm doing this. You know, that's why I started it.
Right.
It was fun out of the back of a piece of junk, you know, S10 pickup truck with bald tires, you know.
Right.
As a nervous novice like everybody else. And then when you get to that level, you just dream of it. And then you get there, you're like, man, you got 50 sponsors with guns to your head. And when you get second, they go, second stinks.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So it's some pressure. So you got to have fun and you got to kind of mix it up. And, you know, I think for a lot of the stuff that we're doing, my wife and I on the Power of the Mind Coach, it's stress impedes performance. So when that mindset, because if you want something so bad, you can literally get so stressed and tight that you ride like a 2x4 and you ride terrible on a motorcycle or a quad. When you flow and have fun, hoot and holler. I used to hoot and holler and jump stuff on a GNCC track that made no sense to jump, but it made fun every lap. I just couldn't wait to jump that big jump across road or do whatever. And everybody's like, what are you doing? I'm like, I'm keeping it fun. And when I had fun, you go fast and you win races. So it's that fine line, you know, because you really want it so bad. It's so hard to go, all right, I want this so bad, I'd literally do anything for it, and yet be detached to the outcome, right? It's the opposite.
It leads to the question, does making it fun make it easy to win, or does it making it easy to win, or being easy to win make it fun?
Both. Right.
Well, came first.
Good question.
Right.
Now, I guess they go hand in hand. Yeah.
I think there, you know, there's a lot to what Stu said there, and you know, everyone's situation is different. And Stu, you know, and we've talked about this before. Here comes, I believe, our leader, Ben Kelly, the 530. Yep. FMF KTM out front pushing, jumping through the monster coal piles there. And we'll see what the gap is. Back to that man right there, not that man, but the man behind him, Stu Baylor. You can see a little bit different rhythm through there, and these guys are just pushing, giving it everything they got. Stu trying everything he has to try to get to the rear wheel, and again, just as we saw 7 miles ago, Ben still not allowing that to happen. So I think we're going to see this race come back together at some point, but I don't know if it may be a situation of it coming down to fuel, which I think we're going to see here in just a couple of minutes.
I measured about 12 and a half seconds between Ben Kelly and Stu Baylor when they came through that section. So still keeping it kind of tight, but at the same time, this is one of those things that you were talking about, Johnny, you know, keeping it tight. But there is that fine line of where it starts to be a little too loose when you keep trying to keep it tight.
Yeah, you know, here is our third place rider, Jordan Ashburn. So we'll see what kind of a gap he has. Essentially none. but it looks now it is Lane Michael there has gotten around Thad Duvall and is now up to the fourth place spot and putting pressure on Jordan Ashburn. And where is Thad Duvall? There is Thad. Actually, no, Trevor Bollinger has now gotten around Thad Duvall. Bollinger up to, so that would be, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, and seventh. So all the way back, Thad has dropped back now from the fourth place spot all the way back to seventh. Or was it? Might have been sixth.
Six,
I don't know. So yeah, top six are through in that shot there. And there was Ben Kelly. Here is Stu Baylor. So still 1 and 2 at the FMF PowerPoint here at the 8 mile marker. And this is a pretty muddy little section along this field. We'll soon switch to our Yamaha live drone. And there it is. You can see Ben Kelly making tracks there to the left of your screen. Heading through those couple of trees. He's going to jump up out here, get some motocross air time, and back on the ground around this hay bale and hard on the hammer, headed towards VP Fuels Pro Road. Look at the bottom of your screen there. You see Stu Baylor going the other way. So these guys know each other where they're at. That's a lapped rider there. No major concern, but it does factor in because I believe Ben Kelly coming into pit and maybe right about there somewhere. So they're actually having to adjust where the pit is going to happen because of the crash.
Yeah,
that was close. Yeah, right there.
They'd adjusted it, seems like, or that's where they were going to pit anyway. But they're saying plus 10 on the board there.
Three laps to go.
And now he looks over, sees Stu Baylor. Stu takes a look at him. So they have that moment, the prize fighters right after the weigh-in, they stand there and they hold their fists up. Well, that moment just happened, but it was right in the middle of VP Fuels Pro Row. Stu Baylor in and gone. A little bit quicker pit stop for Stu. So a couple seconds made up there, but Ben Kelly already on down to the next section of racetrack and continuing to have just a little bit of a gap over his nearest competitor there.
I wonder what look was exchanged between those two.
A lot of respect, honestly, between those two. You know, Ben made several comments the last race, and you can tell he had a bit of a chip on his shoulder. Definitely want to be the guy doing the winning. But it's also evident that these guys both know that they're giving it their all. They're pushing themselves. They're pushing their team. They're pushing their machines. And getting the most out of themselves and each other. And once the adrenaline kind of simmers down a little bit, you know, a large amount of respect between these two riders.
I agree. Just kind of seeing what they're both saying and knowing them both pretty well, as you said, I think they big respect, and I think even Stu trying to contain some of the fans here and there and making sure everything all the way around is just cool. You know what I mean? These guys are both warriors and battling hard, and their teams are, and you know, the best guy's going to win. That puts these next, you know, 3 hours plus 1 hour and 45 minutes or 30 minutes. Yeah,
I did see that post you were referring to where Stu had kind of made some comments that some of his fans were getting pretty unruly with the comments they were making online, taking shots at Ben, taking shots at the series, taking shots at the sport, and they felt that they were supporting Stu. But that's kind of, you know, Stu's a boisterous guy. He's got a lot of boisterous fans, which is great. But they were definitely going too far, and Stu stepped in. And that was a very classy move on his part to say, hey, guys, I can fight my own battles. You know, I appreciate your support, but let's keep it classy. I have a lot of respect for Ben, the series, my sponsors. And I'm going to loop the bike out, and if the Karens want to complain about it, that's fine, but do not engage them. Oh, we got a rider down here.
And he's letting those guys know, hey, why didn't you let me know there was a big hole here in the Monster Mine?
They said, oh, hey, well, we're busy drinking our adult beverage here. Oh, the 514 machine.
Oh, man.
There's a Stu Baylor fan right there. Yeah. But no, it was, in my opinion, it was a very classy post comment by him to say, like, right, hey, guys, a lot of respect between us. Let's keep it respectful between our fans as well. And, you know, Stu Baylor, the hero no one knew they had.
I agree. It was a classy post. Is that what I was getting at also? So it's good. And everybody wants to jump in and put their 2 cents in.
Is that the XC2?
That was the XC2 battle.
Oh, my goodness. They are all together. That was
even the camera guys.
It's Snodgrass, Lafferty, DeLong, Girard, and maybe Barnes all right there together. It looked like there was about five of them.
Yeah, I don't think Barnes was in it, but the other four were for sure. That was the four guys that came through there. Barnes, we saw him actually in the Monster Mile just a moment ago. Looked, he was a little bit further back, at least then.
Yeah, and he is posted at 15 seconds behind. But that Snodgrass, Lafferty, DeLong, and Girard, that was definitely them.
Ben Kelly on screen, it looks like he stretched it back out a little bit even more now. Definitely has. That gap has opened up. That's more than 10 seconds now. Stu Baylor caught behind a lapper, and that can happen quick, Steve.
Yeah, I counted just boogie woogies, but 16 of them. So I think it might be about 16 seconds, give or take a little bit. Yeah, you're right. One lapper, as we know, and not only taking you out, if they don't even take you out, you cross rut and almost come to a stop, and then you have to make another adjustment to get back in a good line.
So here we go. Is Johnny. That Johnny Girard? It is Johnny Girard in the pits. Ryder Lafferty in the pits in front of him. Craig DeLong getting the big wave on. So unless Craig pitted last lap, they're planning on going four laps. Johnny Girard out of the pits. Ryder Lafferty still in the pits, but on his way out. There is Lyndon Snodgrass and Girard right behind him. So Girard the big loser in that one, it looks like. Lost a spot at least to Lyndon Snodgrass. So here is Craig DeLong out front on the number one Rockstar Racing Husqvarna.
Second place right there, Linden Snodgrass on the 178 Monster Energy, Babbitt's Online Kawasaki, 969 to Johnny Girard there in third. And look at this. This is a wheel-to-wheel battle. This is over the second place spot. And ultimately, I'll be honest, I've not done the math, but I think there may be a chance that that man right there, the 969 of Johnny Girard, could lock this one up today if he finishes well enough.
It's getting close. Yeah.
Yep, I'm pretty sure that's what he was telling me yesterday. I forget the exact math, but I think it all lands correctly.
He's riding one-handed, and he's dropped a bunch of time there. It looked like he was fiddling his drink system. Again, nothing to be super concerned about, but he was in a battle with the 178 of Lyndon Snodgrass. Now, here is the 282 of Mike Witkowski, a rider that normally would be battling with those guys for a podium in the XC2 class. But again, today he has actually opted to ride the XC1 class and has, you know, kind of lost the draft, lost the pace there of XC1. He's back there about sixth in the XC2 class, and which would leave him about 16, 17 overall somewhere.
How many boogie woogies did Craig DeLonga gain there by chance?
I didn't count boogie woogies for him.
It looked like it was about 8 boogie woogies. 8 to 10 boogie woogies.
I'm a Mississippi man myself.
Yeah. I'm a 1,000. 1,000, 2, 1,000.
I do that a lot.
Man,
too.
Boogie like woogie, that's long.
I say I'm fast. One boogie woogie.
One boogie woogie, two boogie woogie. All right, yeah, 1,000.
Because I go too fast for 1,000.
It all works, though. That's the funny thing.
We're within 10 seconds apart, right? Yeah. Don't take this to heart.
We're getting close enough. All the years of stopwatches, I just, unless it's not a science when you're trying to give a rider a pit board.
Right.
It's an idea, and they want to know, is that number getting bigger or smaller? So it doesn't matter if you're boogie woogieing, you're 1,000 in, you're right. Mississippian. If there's more Mississippis boogie woogies or thousands than there was the last time, you got a happy rider. If there's less, they're not so happy. They don't want that gap to come down. Right now, the gap going up for Ben Kelly. Looks like he's stretched it out a little bit more over the 514 of Stu Baylor. 16 boogie woogies is what we counted last, and they'll be checking in, and we'll have some official down to the thousands of how many seconds can separate these two here in a matter of just about there at the just past the 10-mile marker. They got about a mile to go until they check in at the scoring tent here for lap number 4 complete.
Well, I know overall our leaders, Kelly and Baylor, do in about a minute and 30 seconds. So a couple minutes behind that, we'll probably be seeing that battle for the XC2 250 Pro class.
I did thousands for you, Johnny. It's about the same. 16.
So Steve has calling it out here, roughly 16 seconds. You can see the gap on screen. Oh, good there for a minute, but it's gone now.
I'll try yours next time.
Here is second and third in that XC2 class. We'll assume that our leader, Craig DeLong, has already gone by there at the 10-mile marker. And here is Stu Baylor on screen working his way through, just about to reach the 11-mile marker. It's just down there in those woods right before we see that split line where they'll be coming at us here in just a matter of a minute. And there is Ben Kelly. Here is the 11-mile marker. He just passed it. He's got a turn. He's got a couple more little chicanes here. He's going to pop out into a field, and then he's going to be on his way to the finish line complete for lap number 4. And from what the pit board said, it said 3 more laps. I don't know if they're saying that means it's going to be a 6-lap race. I think what they were saying is 3 more when they complete this one. So it'll end up being 7 laps, 6 full laps, and our short 7.5-minute laps. If I've done my math correct, that's how it should be.
That should put us close in the neighborhood of where we need to be for 3 hours worth of racing. And I'll tell you right now, 1 hour and 30 minutes into this race, I'm not going to say it's been a long race, but I think the anticipation of this championship fight is really making this seem like it's, I've been on the edge of my seat for an hour and a half, and it seems like so much longer than that right now.
Imagine being in the goggles with Ben and Stu, right? Feels like they're 9-hour races all of a sudden.
Oh, there he is.
I imagine Ben right now has got to be feeling a little breezier than what Stu is seeing that gap. But here's where it comes into the lap traffic. We're starting to see even in some of these open fields some lap traffic. So those tighter sections could tighten things up as we are nearing the completion of this lap 4 officially. Of course, our third full lap.
I think it went down to maybe 13-ish, so we'll see here in a minute.
28:11. So a little bit, he dropped back. He lost some time, or they slowed down 28:10 for Baylor. So it looks like they are all slowing down. At least they did on that lap, and that could be because of lap traffic or a number of different reasons, I'm sure. But that's usually what we account that for. Jordan Ashburn Duval, Michael, and the guys that were battling behind them, we still wait for them. They were about 37 seconds behind that. That gap has likely widened just a little bit, too.
Yeah, Jordan Ashburn was in the third place spot last week, but he had a lot of heat coming behind him. The Ampro Yamaha, Lane Michael, looking to rebound after a rough round just 2 weeks ago, ultimately not finishing, having some, I believe, some migraine issues and having a crash and all kinds of stuff 2 weeks ago at the Baroque GNCC. And now he's working his way. We've got a photo shoot going on here. I keep seeing her hold that pit board, and there's no riders coming. I realized there was someone taking a photo, so we gotcha. And look at this. We got a new third-place rider is what we got on screen. The 5-2-3 of Lane Michael has taken over the third-place spot. He's wrestled it away from Jordan Ashburn and does not seem to have Jordan Ashburn in his rearview mirror, at least at the moment. So a recharged, refocused Lane Michael, hard on the charge, and he's currently running third place spot.
Well, if you remember before the summer break, we were starting to see these good charges by Lane Michael, and we always talked about that hour and a half mark, and he was starting to surpass the hour and a half mark, and we were starting to see better and stronger finishes out of him.
That was just a camera angle thing. Jordan Ashburn is right there. we couldn't see him for a minute. Well, he must have been invisible, because now he's back and he's right there. Back on screen, the 5:30 of Ben Kelly. That is the white rider you see there going around just off the right side of your screen. We'll wait and we'll watch. And there is Stu Baylor making a pass on a lapper.
That looks just like him.
Every Yamaha rider is Stu Baylor, and every KTM rider is Ben Kelly.
They've even got the same gear on.
Right. White helmet, blue gear.
They do.
So there's the gap, folks. The bike at the top of your screen, far left, that is Ben Kelly disappearing into the shadows. The bike in the chicane right there, the blue Yamaha of Stu Baylor. That's the gap. That's the tail of the tape at the moment. And, man, this one has kind of been at a stalemate for almost three full laps now. It's over two laps that this gap has been right in that 8 to 16-second range, and it fluctuates a little, but it never gets more, and it never gets less than that. It just kind of goes back and forth within that. You know, they can see each other in the fields. They can't see each other so much in the woods, but they can hear each other's bikes. They know they're there, but they're just not in the same section of racetrack.
Craig DeLong from the XC2 250 class now checking through the wood section there. That lead that he was able to capture there seems to still be somewhat comfortable. They are still chasing him down, but he's been able to do a lot with that, it looks like.
Yeah, Lyndon Snodgrass right there in second still, and there is Ben Kelly through and out into that big field section out at about the 1.5. Stu Baylor coming through as well. You can see the mud fleas down in there with the stick pointing them where to go. But Craig DeLong stretching out a little bit, but Lyndon Snodgrass and Johnny Girard hard on the charge and trying to keep him honest, trying to keep him right there because they want to be in that battle for the lead and ultimately for the win. Such a cool shot here from this right Yamaha here. Racing live drone. I mean, it's cool to see the speed, like you talked about earlier, Rodney, with how the lines develop and how time is gained and lost. I mean, this is a real-time bird's-eye view of getting to see these guys battle it out.
Stu Baylor also trying to work his way through some lap traffic now as Ben Kelly just seems to be slipping further and further away. I don't know if it's – ooh, down goes Baylor. Baylor just went down right there.
Right before the tree. Must have hit like a tree root or something.
Yeah, so he washed out. This could be detrimental. He's not up and going yet. There he goes. Uh-oh. Well, that right there might be enough to shake him up and aggravate him enough to get the hammer down. You know, it's funny how, you know, some riders that would make them maybe drop back a little bit. He's the exact opposite. That's the kind of thing that would fire him up and make him ride faster and harder.
It may play to be true. We've seen it so many times. I mean, it's...
Especially if he broke a brake pedal or shifter or something.
Another little mistake right there, though. So sometimes what it can cause is when you start pushing, you know, you start missing your lines and overriding the track. But Stu's got a lot of experience. I think even if he does start to feel frustrated, he'll compose himself and, you know, go back after Ben and do the best that he can to try to run him down. But, you know, if you want to talk about a mad Baylor, if we think back to the John Penton GNCC this spring when they had a little... fuel stop malfunction and some of that race gas was right in Mr. Baylor's lap. You know, once he stopped, took that little cooling, you know, dip in the creek and rinsed himself off to get all that gasoline off. Man, I think that is the hardest charge we've maybe ever seen from Stu Baylor in that last lap and a half of racing. So we know the speed this guy has, and it's just a question of is it today? Is he going to be able to put it all together? He's won, what are we in, six races now in seven races so far here in 2021 after sitting out. You know, it's funny, earlier in the show, Steve, you made the comment. You said, you know, these guys know it can't be won in the first race. And you got to note, Stu Baylor wasn't even in the first race. So he definitely couldn't win it in round one. But here we are, you know, 10 rounds later, 11 rounds later now, but 10 rounds later at round 11, he captured the points lead. So a man on a mission through 11 rounds. But right now, man on a mission is Ben Kelly. And, you know, we theorize, we talk, we strategize. Like, what does losing the points lead mean? Does that fire Ben up? Does it actually relax him? What does having the leader's plate do to Stu? Does that, you know, does that bolster his confidence even more? Or now is he the one with the weight on his shoulders? And we're seeing it all play out on screen. We still don't know how it's going to end. But right now, Ben Kelly is the benefactor of not having the points lead. And Stu Baylor, with that crash in the field, maybe feeling the weight of that number plate just a little bit.
You know, one thing that I think Stu can also bank on, he is a numbers kind of guy. And he knows, you know, he's got his strong tracks and he's got his strong places and he knows when to rise to the occasion and so forth, and he's got 2 weeks to play the mind games as well. He, you know, this second place position is not the worst place in the world for him today. It won't be detrimental. I mean, yeah, he'll relinquish the points lead, but it also has him still within the win. If he takes the win and beats Ben at the Ironman, then he's got the championship, and that's the ultimate goal for him. So, you know, as much pressure as you think being in second place might put on someone, I think Stu might be approaching it a little bit differently.
Yeah, I mean, I definitely don't feel like pressure would be the right word for Stu sitting in second place. I think he's fine there. Like, he can see Ben to this point. Now, after that mistake, if Ben's able to open it up, let's say that gap goes from, you know, 16 to suddenly it's 46, that's when Stu is going to have to make the decision, like you said. Am I okay letting this thing go on to Ironman and just let Ben ride away from me, or am I going to put a charge in? And I think we know the answer. Yeah. Stu Baylor's not going to just relinquish a win. He's going to fight for this one to the end.
Well, those questions and many more will be settled before this one is all said and done. Stu Baylor trying to track down Ben Kelly is out front, and the battle for third wages on. Lane Michaels in the spot. Can Jordan Ashburn strike back? Stick around to find out. The Buckwheat 100 GNCC continues on Racer TV after this.
How's it going? It's Lane Michael here. You're watching GNCC Racing at racertv.com.
Even when you're the best, you never stop striving to be better. With over 40 years of experience in motorcycle sales and service, we know racing. Our inventory of Yamaha motorcycles, sport bikes, dirt bikes, ATVs, and side-by-sides is extensive and constantly changing. Stop by LoJack Cycle Sales today in Tarentum, Pennsylvania, and visit our online inventory at www.lojacks.com. Yamaha YZs. It's why we ride.
Hi, my name is Andrea Lee, the director of On Track School. How would you like to go to a school where we take into consideration how students learn best? Well, we do that because we find if we can build the curriculum around the things you are interested in, you're going to do a better job. The mission at On Track School is that educational success is possible while chasing your dreams. Not only will our staff help students to achieve success, they will cheer you on to the finish line. We encourage you to check out On Track School at ontrackschool.com, where we can help you chase your dreams and still get a quality education.
are American motorcyclists. We are members of the American Motorcyclist Association. Racers, fans, and crew, we come together for this sport we love, to race together, to grow together. We start young and not so young. We race motorcycles and ATVs. We become friends, we become family. We compete for weekend bragging rights and national championships. We make memories on the toughest off-road courses in the country and on the best motocross tracks in the world. Some of us aspire to the speed and poise of road racing or the fierce competitiveness of American flat track. And we honor our greatest champions in the AMA Motorcycle Hall of Fame. Through it all, we cheer. We win and we lose. We are racing. We are the AMA. Race with us. Be part of the greatest sport in the world. Be an American motorcyclist. Join us today at www.amajoin.com/join-now.
Brown's RV Superstore is family-owned and operated and staked their reputation on offering you the finest RVs available in their McBee, South Carolina RV dealership. Brown's RV Superstore carries motorhomes, fifth wheels, travel trailers, and toy haulers, and keep a huge inventory of new and used RVs in stock for you to choose from. They offer top dollar for your RV trade-in and help you get the RV financing you need. As a part of the GNCC family, Brown's RV Superstore, in partnership with Vengeance Toy Haulers, offers sponsorship packages for every level of racer with discounts and continued savings on your new toy hauler. Brown's RV Superstore has dedicated themselves to complete customer satisfaction, specializing in providing a positive start to your RV adventure. They look forward to customers coming back to share their tales from the road. Call Brown's RV Superstore today at 877-805-3658 or visit their website at brownsrvsuperstore.com, where family fun begins.
And GNCC Live continues here on RacerTV.com, where, well, the amateurs are the monumental part of the weekend here in GNCC, as they make up 95% of the riders on the start lines here throughout the course of the weekend. So we want to take a little bit of a time to focus on those, like our Junior AB 25 Plus class, led by Caleb Haynes, Tyler Brunton in the number two spot, Grant Marriott in third, Dave Mushisco was your fourth place ride. We'll check back in with the rest of those guys in a moment. Bet A 30 Plus class, Andrew Smith leading Joshua Brown, Tom Truxell in the number three spot, Joe Marsh is fourth, and Mark Horesco, a name I haven't said in a while, rounds out your top five there out of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Smiling Frank Messina leading this one out of Campbell Hall, New York, with Shotgun Sean Remington running in the number two spot. He actually got the whole shot. Joe Dean in third. Surly Amazio is fourth, and Benny Comick in the number five spot of the Senior A 40 Plus class. The Open B class sees Landon Rogers out of Lumberport, West Virginia, over Austin Hovatter, who got the whole shot out of Arthur Dow, literally about 10 miles or so down the road from where we are right now. Andrew Veit out of Auburn, New Hampshire's third. Burke Marsiglia and Michael Horwat round out your top four and five riders in the class. 250B class, Andrew Inman leading Colton Shields with Rodrigo Correa, Hayden Serena, and Landon Beatty rounding out the top five. A lot of local names in that one as well. Brady Weimer out of Frostburg, Maryland, leading Aiden Myers out of North Carolina, with Blaine Barrier now in the number three spot. Peyton Gwynn is fourth, and Harvey Bull rounds out your top five in the 150B class. The four-stroke B lights class sees Levi Elliott from Hickory, North Carolina, another off-road hot spot, and Anthony Blackburn back in the number two spot. Gunnar Yeo is third, Garrett Mundy in fourth, and Thomas Allen rounds out your top five there in the four-stroke B lights class. The Vet B 30 Plus class sees Fernando Xavier out of Burnsville, Minnesota, leading David Smith in the number two spot. Michael Funk in third. Julio Lubiana in the number four spot out of Massachusetts, and Ryan Razratorski out of Cuyahoga Falls, Ohio, rounds out your top five. I believe he might have gotten the whole shot. Senior B 40 Plus, William Hollenbeck out of Kennerdale, Pennsylvania, leading Scott Dallin. Third place then, Brent Newsom. Adam Nastic is fourth, and Felipe Baranger rounds out your top five, Senior B 40 Plus. There's a look at your XC1 Pro standings last time through. Kelly Baylor, Lane Michael, Jordan Ashburn, Trevor Bollinger. Then it was Duvall, Toad Strang, Russell, and Mike Witkowski rounding out the top 10 in the class. The XC2250 Pro breakdown is DeLong, Girard, Snodgrass 1, 2, and 3, Cody Barnes in 4th, Ryder Lafferty dropping back to 5th now,
Rui Barbosa is 6th, Jesse Ansley in 7th, Ben Nelko in 8th, Jonathan Johnson 9th, and Simon Johnson rounding out your top 10. And your FMF XC3 125 Pro-Am, Hunter Neuwirth with Jason Lipscomb leading Jake Froman, who is 3rd, Noah Clark in 4th, Eli Childers in 5th, Michael Pillar 6th, Max Fernandez, Zachary Garys, John Wells, and Jeremy Lallement round out your top 10. Actually, that was open A, Jeremy Lallement. It's Jason Tino, Tyler Braniff, Ezra Prine, Tyler Soriano, and Dylan Dela Cruz are top five in the open A class now. And 258 class, JoJo Cunningham leading Tristan Landrum. Both Nelsonville, Ohio riders. Will Stephen Piper out of Cumming, Georgia in third. Bubs Tasha out of the New England area in fourth. Neil Inman rounds out your top five out of Bangor, Pennsylvania. The 158 class, Sean Myers out of Reimersburg in PA, leading Caleb Baltimore. Jaden Donners in the number three spot. Hunter Smith is fourth, and Ryan Piper rounds out your top five 150A riders. And that is your rundown now of amateur riders here in the GNCC Racing Nation. And, of course, speaking of Racing Nation, a name that we haven't really heard a whole lot of in a while, and finally had the chance to. I ran into him so many times at the races, but then all of a sudden I don't see him on the starting line. Talking about Corey Buttrick out of Factory Beta Racing. And Corey, welcome to the show, and welcome here to the Buckwheat 100. You seem to be pretty busy out here right now.
Yeah, it's a new level of busy now, a different kind of busy. But yeah, had a few minutes, thought I'd stop in, talk to you boys about some car insurance or something. And Stu is getting down through there, man.
Yeah,
dropping the hammer.
Yeah.
I could tell coming through the pits last lap, he still had that look in his eye. Like, obviously, Kelly lit one up and was trying to pull out, but Stu wasn't going to let that happen. And what a lap Lane had.
Yeah.
Made up some ground.
Yeah, Lane has certainly lit it on fire. And these are the kind of rides, you know, we were starting to see out of him earlier in the year, and then seemed like something happened there over the break. And, well, at least the last couple of rounds, we just didn't see that kind of fire out of him. But, man, he's back on it again, so he's fired back up. And that's kind of bad news for Jordan Ashburn now.
Yeah, well, Lane's got the train back on the track. So, yeah, it looks like if they keep that bike upright, keep him moving forward, he's going to have a good day.
Well, Corey B., I know a lot of questions are being asked. Why aren't you on the racetrack? What is going on? Why aren't you racing now?
Basically, now I'm taking over, like, assistant team manager role for Beta. Had the opportunity to have this option basically after the last time I got hurt. It was funny, the first couple phone calls and boys sent me, I thought I was getting fired. They were asking me about my future and racing and what I thought, and I'm like, man, I don't know, I just want to keep going, you know, I'm having fun. And I just kept telling them that if my knee stays together, I'll keep racing. Like, we still haven't seen the best. I still have a lot more to offer.
Right.
But yeah, extremely grateful for this opportunity, and we're making the most of it. You know, we basically have new race shop in Carroll, Ohio, two new mechanics, and we were dropping the hammer, just trying to get everything, our ducks in a row, and we're going to show up here and put on a good showing.
That's awesome, man. I'm glad to see you found a home. As Baylor checking in, we saw the 5:30 of Ben Kelly going through there about 20 seconds or so ago. But again, Baylor's still back in the number two spot, it appears. But yeah, good news for the Beta team. Good news for you, because now you don't have to worry about getting that phone call because you got an injured knee or something like that, and saying now you know when they call, you're going to be talking team tactics and stuff like that.
Yeah, exactly. And it's way less stressful with the family and, you know, not having to train and stuff. But yeah, different kind of stress. You know, during the week now, you're Kelly coming through the pits now, Stu's still behind him. But it's good. It's a good adjustment, and definitely a lot less worries, you know.
And you'll probably be a race dad here pretty soon, the way things are.
Yeah, that's the next problem, man. We're trying to sort that out. I was talking to one of my buddies that went and bought an electric 50 yesterday, and he was talking about it being $5,700. I'm like, oh, man. I was like, Dad's going to need two or three more jobs. I was like, that's crazy, man.
Yeah.
But you do anything for him, though. And, yep. And to see the kid smile, I mean, it's always worth it.
Yeah. Speaking of smiles right now, you know there's got to be a big one on this guy's face, but I'm sure – he is not resting just yet, because he knows there's a long road to hoe as far as this Buckwheat 100 GNCC is concerned. And he knows that Stu Baylor is still back there. At the finish line, he was 9 seconds. This gap has ever bit doubled that to 20 or more now, as Baylor is making his way
But unfortunately for Ben, that's sort of the last guy you want behind you.
Yeah.
I mean, he's proven it time and time again now. I mean, apparently he's not too concerned until the white flag flies.
I don't even think a minute you can feel comfortable.
No. And for most guys, we'd say, well, we're about out of it. We'll send it, see what we got. But Stu's like, oh, we're still in the race. So, yeah, good for him. Looking good, chugging along, man.
So do you get a chance to talk to these guys much being in your new role or anything?
It's weird. You're always going to do something. Like, everything is so purposeful now, you know, like during the race weekends, you're always going to do something. But no, we still get to chat with them a good bit, especially when we get out the pedal and stuff. And I didn't get to do a whole lot of it since it was still so wet here this weekend. But it's cool. I mean, I still have the racer mindset and mentality, and I'm really hoping that's what's going to really help out with the beta guys here, you know, still being relevant and just putting our knowledge to work. You know, it's the best we can do.
That's awesome, Corey. I'm glad to see that things are going well for you, and you're moving in a good direction as far as the industry is concerned. We're talking with Corey Buttrick, the 121. Corey B., now I guess we could say you're a retired XC1 Pro Class racer?
Yeah, I guess so. It stinks. I had Lane Michaels coming through the pits now, still in third. And it was looking like I was going to finish the year, and then when I realized how busy we really were there, trying to get a shop together and basically pick up the pieces the kind of mid-season, you know, to reorganize this thing and go racing again. I was like, man, we're pulling some hours, and I haven't got the train. I was telling myself, I was like, well, I haven't trained in 8 weeks now. I was like, well, that's bad news. And because the thing is I, you know what it's like, you don't want to show up and not give it your best. So I don't know if I could even ride to the starting line right now and even feel good about myself not knowing I hadn't been putting in the work. But I might show up on a 250 at Ironman and go rip a whole shot.
That would be pretty cool. Man, this is awesome. I'm sitting here, I'm watching Lane Michael through this section of the racetrack. He is as strong as I've
looking
seen
racy, and there's Ashburn still behind him, right about 5 seconds.
Yeah, that
and then Thad's on Ashburn.
Wow, Thad back at it again. So he's gotten back around Trevor Bollinger. He'd gotten passed by Bollinger just before the end of
that
lap.
Last lap.
Yeah, so he's gotten back around, and that's good news to see Thad with that pep here, I guess you could say, in the second half of the race. We're approaching the 2 hour mark at an hour and 53 minutes. So Ben Kelly already through here at the 10-mile marker, what we call Method Alley from Method Race Wheels. And, of course, have you signed up for your Method Race Wheels?
I have not. You know what? I just got my flyer for the first time pulling in. Well, see, the issue now is since I'm showing up all professional, getting here on Thursday and whatnot, I don't get the cool stuff at the gate. But, man, that's a trick. I seen them. So we got one this time because we got here a little bit later on Friday.
Yeah, you can win $500.
And Stu rolling through now. BK just came through.
So we got, well, I'll talk about this. Got a minute and 16 seconds back to Lane Michael right now. Point the camera at the code in this this thing that you get. Register at each race. Install decal on your helmet. Post a photo with the hashtag MRWGNCC. And go get them, Tiger. You can win $500 or even $10,000 plus a set of wheels.
Go put some wheels on your ride, man. You put new shoes on her, it feels like new.
Yeah. Speaking of new, Josh Strang is expecting a new son in this world, and he may be here already. I know they left this morning at 4 a.m. We'd made mention of that this earlier, but that's been kind of the talk of the pits the last couple of days as to whether Josh was going to be able to make it, whether the baby was going to be here before. But you know what's really cool is I think that his team manager, Fred Anders, and the guys, he's a family guy too, you know, and that's family first, and I think that's cool the way Fred looks at that. So hopefully the baby will hold off until Josh gets back home.
That'd be good.
But if not, you know, the beauty of it is he'll get the meeting.
He's going to be home soon.
Yep, exactly.
Yeah, good thing Josh is tough. He's out there doing what he does, man. Just keep plugging away.
1 hour and 55 minutes into the race, so an hour and 5 minutes, give or take a few minutes here and there. I'm not sure.
Looked like Craig DeLong there coming out of the pits.
But I tell you, what a crafty move by Craig DeLong, who
maybe not.
But even with that, even if that, that's him.
Yeah.
A very crafty move as he got waved through the pits. I mean, good team strategy there for the Husqvarna folks, and not only that, just good riding for him because he's taken full advantage of this circumstance and situation. However, right there, the
Linden's
one step
still behind him.
Yes, looks like Linden may be keeping that pace. I think when they came through, he had – 5 seconds. Yeah, just about half a second, actually. Half a second's what he had. But that was with Jonathan Gerrard there. It was there at the pit stop where everything got jumbled around.
Yeah, the first lap looked like Johnny switched gloves. He must have got stuck probably down there behind the pits, I'm guessing.
Yeah, I heard the report from Mikey Waynes was he went down in some mud, got some mud on the gloves, so he came in and changed, got a drink of water, and headed on out. And it seems to have paid
Ryder
off.
Ryder Lafferty there, probably. Or was he still in third? Or no, he was back to fifth, I think.
Yeah, let's see. Let's go back down to the XC2 class here. Lafferty in fifth, yes. Okay. So it was DeLong, Gerrard, Snodgrass, Cody Barnes, and Ryder Lafferty checking in at the end of lap four. 10 seconds was the gap between DeLong and Gerrard. So we see that Snodgrass has made up about 5 seconds. He's gotten around Gerrard, it looked like, there for a second. And
they should be heading into the finish now.
Yeah, so we'll get a look at what's going on there. Let's see where our leaders are at right now. And 2 minutes is when we expect to see our leaders checking
in. Figured it's about due.
Yeah, so we'll be watching with bated breath, so to speak, as there goes Baylor through now, I believe.
They get the two-lap board this time?
That's what I would anticipate.
They were right at 30 minutes. It happened to be a six-lap race. So.
Yeah, if they come in, they're going to be coming in right at the two-hour mark itself. They're running 28-minute laps, so they should get the two-lap board.
On his way down in.
Yeah, so with a two-lap board, 28 minutes, that should put us 2 hours, 56 minutes or so. Before we see checkers, it could speed up, it could slow down a little bit, but right now,
What a cool shot, man. Yeah. That's so awesome. Stu's on the hammer.
Look how much that section of track has developed. You can see the acceleration bumps down through there.
Went from a soupy mess on Friday to seeing some dust out here now. That wraps GNCC up in a weekend, man. It tells
doesn't
you how,
it though?
How quick things change. Go from getting pulled in here to leaving a nice track when you're pulling out.
Yeah, barely making it in if you made it in on Thursday night.
That's right.
It was a real toad strangler came through. But, man, yeah, like you say, a lot of this soil has changed so much. If you watched yesterday, just a totally different feel, totally different look to this very exact same race course.
Probably about as good as it's going to get right now, all things considered, because any drier, it's probably going to start getting slicker again.
Talking with some trail sweeps from this morning, they were just in love with the course. They said perfect race conditions.
Yeah, man, this one looked like a fun one. There's certain races I can tell already hurt more than others. Like Stu rolling in.
Got a big group of riders just ahead of him, too, so he's going to have to try to get through those.
Luck of the draw, here comes Kelly into the finish.
Yeah, so I'm going to expect we're at 20 seconds or better. We may be looking closer to 30 now between first and second.
Yeah, the gap is growing, that's for sure.
So we'll get an accurate account of that here in just a moment as Johnny Gallagher is stepping back in with us. And still no sign of Stu here in the finish line region. And that's going to give, possibly, unless we just missed him somehow or another, give Lane an opportunity to catch up.
Yeah, I think Lane, at last check, at
minute 16.
Minute 16. Yeah. And I think what's happened right now is Ben has re-upped the pace. I think we're going to see, when we look at Ben's lap time, which it should be in, what was Ben's lap time that
27:58, so he did it up about 15 seconds or so.
So, yeah, that's I think that's what we're seeing here. That's why the gap's opened up. And, again, we saw that crash on camera in the field section. Stu, far from done here, but it is.
48 seconds.
Yeah, but it's still Stu Baylor in second, man. And there's only so much you can say. And if you're BK, that's still the last dude you want behind you, unfortunately.
It is, but, I mean, you got to take your small victories.
Right now he's doing it in stride, though. He's got to keep doing what he's doing. He's plugging away.
To put him 46 seconds down, he's done something right. If he keeps doing that, that's all he can
control. One more clean lap, and BK's going to be sitting pretty.
Yeah, he can't control the Baylor charge that we've seen so much. All he can do is put in his best lap. And I think that's what's so frustrating is a lot of times we'll see that, when those gaps get closed down like that, it's not that the rider in front slows down. It's that Grant and Stu are prone to just wick it up there at the end of these races. That's not if you're thinking that's Lane Michael, it's not just yet. That's what's so frustrating is that those guys will just pour the coal to it there at the end. But if you're Ben Kelly, all you can do is do your laps, put in, and make him earn it if he's going to come get you. And right now, he stretched that gap out to 46
seconds. He's doing his job. He's doing what he should be doing. So that's how you win a championship.
There he is on screen, left side of your screen. That's Ben Kelly along the fence there. A little bit getting into the rut wall just a little bit there.
Yeah, caught an edge.
It's getting to that point. That's how the track is
right
now. Now, Lane Michael, third place,
checking in with the podium position in hand. Ooh. Ben Kelly riding along that fence line there again, backhand stepping out. Track is
1:16.8. It only changed
the same.
A few tenths of a second is all it changed.
Good lap for Lane then. He's keeping it together. It seems like right now if keep that bike upright, he's obviously got the pace again, that's for sure. Things are clicking again. Good for him.
28:37.5 for Stu Baylor, 28:37.7 for Lane Michael. I mean, almost identical lap times.
0.2 seconds, that's a big gain there.
Step in the right direction, boys. It's a little one.
Hey, we talked about it before. You'd rather gain it than lose it.
Heard that. Things are looking good.
See, when I was out Stu there, Rodney, I was walking by there, there is Stu on the right side of your screen, or upper left right now, but right as you're looking at it. There's a barn burn going on in that XC2 class, Rodney. Those guys came by, and, I mean, there's three different battles going on the track, and they're all pretty much wheel-to-wheel, and they're just ringing.
Stu.
Another mistake from Stu.
Drove her in there.
And it seems like the mistakes from Stu that we're seeing, with the exception, I didn't see what caused the crash, but the other ones are really, it seems he's just trying so hard.
Yep. Typical kind of bulldog Stu is how it looks, but then again, he usually gets away with it, and you're like, man, he'll blow through the berms, and here there's little hiccups. But
As much as I've seen it, I have to wonder if there's some offsetting or something, you know, something's happened to the suspension or something that could be.
Well, I know he said something to the boys the first lap when he came through the pits, and it was relatively smart. He shut the bike off coming through the pits to yell at Corey McDonald, restarted the bike, and I'm like, that was pretty dang smart.
Yeah, that's I would never think of that. The guy keeps his head about him while he's racing, that's for sure. But I think what we're seeing is the forks are a little soft here because that front number plate weighs a little more.
Yeah, exactly. You've got that white background
man,
on
that
there.
That heavy.
They say that's an easy 8 pounds on those things.
Ben Kelly, I believe that is Ben, through there. And a little doggy paddle, but hey, man.
Straight through the middle.
It doesn't have to look pretty. You just got to get through there quick. Yep.
It'll be interesting to see XC2 what we get out of Girard now, because I was told today he's got to finish fourth or better probably for the championship, and so it'd be interesting to see if he pours it back on now to run these boys down, because he lost a good handful of time there that first lap.
He's back. When I saw him physically out on the track, I believe he was
there,
in
he is.
Third
well,
place
never
spot.
Mind. That's probably like Rick.
That is Ricky there.
Yep.
So the 212 of Ricky Russell.
Rick's still.
Ricky is now in class, ninth in class.
Gotcha. But that is Johnny Girard right behind him. So don't know if we missed Craig DeLong. Has Craig DeLong checked in, Rodney?
Not yet.
So we got a new leader in XC2, and it's this man right here, the 969, the points leader, and a man on his way to potentially clinching the XC2 250 Pro 2021 Championship. Taking a look over his shoulder, seeing where his competitors, there is Craig DeLong. It looks to be going the other way. It is the number one Rockstar Husqvarna in second. That will not be enough to extend this into one more round. He needs to get around Johnny Girard, and he needs to motivate some of those other guys behind him to come with him if he wants to keep this championship hope alive for one more round, folks.
Get the train rolling, Stu, back out on the grass track. Yeah, anytime we get here in these fall kind of races, those are the ones that get me geeked up. When I see the dirt's nice and it's starting to cool off a little bit, you know what it's like just being a Yankee all the time. You're like, man, this is our time of the year. This is when we really shine.
You get that moisture that the dirt gets good. You got some grip.
And
in
plus,
it.
It's getting slick. Anytime we start heading north, I'm like, oh, yeah. That's where it's at.
Well, I think what's getting a lot of people geeked up right now, Corey and Rodney, is the fact that right now, the way things stand with Stu Baylor having a one-point lead, if he would win this race, ultimately, you know, The one point almost is inconsequential because of the points gaps. But what's happening right now is Ben Kelly would be 4 points in the lead, meaning it's going to come down to a mano-a-mano showdown at Ironman. And realistically, whichever way this one plans out, it still does. But there's a few more, you know, scenarios if you're Ben Kelly with a four-point lead. If neither one of them win, then Ben would only need to finish ahead of Stu, whereas if, you know, Stu being behind, he would need to beat Ben by more than one position to clinch the championship. So the points lead is always nice, but what it comes down to is the ding, ding, ding prize flight, and we're 2 hours and 5 minutes into this one, so we'd say we're about seven rounds deep into this one right now today.
So the two-lap card is out. We are less than 2 hours, or two laps away, less than an hour away now from seeing checkers flying on this one. And again, you know, I mean, this you know, I said it at the hour and a half mark, and I'll say it again here just past the two-hour mark. Man, this is certainly making for a long day. There's been some excitement, and I don't want to say that there hasn't been a lot of excitement, but the thing about it's just like a waiting game that we're waiting on right now.
Still what you want to see, your championship guys up front, toe-to-toe. And either way, everybody knows as long as these boys both stay upright today, it still carries on the iron, man, like no matter what happens. So this is kind of the grand finale here. It's heading into it.
Jonathan Gerard leading the XC2. Ben Kelly nearly a minute over Stu Baylor. GNCC Live continues after this.
Rocky Mountain ATV MC, retailer, distributor, manufacturer, product developer, parts tester. This is what we do, but who we are is something much simpler. We're riders, like you. 100% employee owned and operated, a company built by riders, entirely for riders. Rocky Mountain ATV MC, get ready.
The directive: advance human performance beyond biological limitation.
Born of family values and a homegrown work ethic, Kometic Gaskets seals your machine so you can focus on the finish line. Kometic Gaskets are the competitive standard for racers who demand the very best. Kometic Gaskets are constructed from superior materials designed to perform in the most demanding environment. Whether it's championships on the line or a day in the dirt with friends, professionals and enthusiasts depend on Kometic. Kometic Gaskets, sealing championships since 1989.
AMSOIL runs on freedom and has since 1972. We changed the industry by formulating the first API-qualified 100% synthetic motor oil. The rest of the market has been trying to follow our lead ever since. But a head start is a head start. We punish our products firsthand in our world-class laboratories and beyond. Because some things can't be learned from a test tube. Run with us.
Last season was my best season ever by far. I won a lot of races, I won the championship, and it was also my first year using Arma. And one of the things I noticed was just my ability to string good days together. You know, like especially in the summertime in Florida where you're riding every day and the heat index is 108 degrees and you're doing 230s and going to the gym and bicycle and all that stuff. I think in the past I've been super inconsistent day to day. Yeah, I may have a, you know, a good race here or, you know, a good day during the week there, but overall, I think where I improved the most was my consistency in my recovery.
Yeah.
Welcome back to GNCC Live on RacerTV.com. Rodney Tomlin along with Johnny Gallagher. Mikey Wayne's out and about, and looks like Ben Kelly on a mission to regain that points lead, as he's got nearly a 50-second lead over Stu Baylor, the now and new points leader after last round of racing. And, of course, a bit of a minute and 16-second gap back to third place now. Lane Michael, who is honestly, I'm going to say it, putting on the best. We've seen some good shows out of him earlier in the year, but this is the best we've seen so far this season.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's, you know, we've seen Lane, he kind of struggled at the last round. As we said, kind of retired early, had some issues with the migraine and I believe a crash, ultimately taking him out of competition late in that one. Back today with a vengeance in that third place position and fought for it. Came from back in about seventh, worked his way up, got around Thad DeVall, got around Trevor Bollinger, got around Jordan Ashburn, and it looks, at least for the time being, that he has shaken Jordan Ashburn. Don't know exactly what the gap was back to fourth, but he's a minute and 16 seconds behind his teammate Stu Baylor, who's running in second, who is 46 seconds back of your race leader Ben Kelly. What we were talking about a little bit before the break was the points as they run and how this finish today for Ben Kelly and Stu Baylor would affect them. Here's why today is so big for Ben Kelly. If he pulls off this win and can relegate Stu Baylor to second, he controls his own destiny going into Ironman. He'll have a four-point lead, meaning he only needs to finish ahead of Stu Baylor. If Stu Baylor wins today, Ben Kelly finishes second, with Stu already having a one-point advantage, that would mean the advantage would be Stu Baylor by six, meaning even if Ben Kelly wins Ironman, Stu Baylor need only finish second to clinch the championship. Therefore, today is huge if you're Ben Kelly. If you're Stu Baylor, you can afford to give it up a little bit. You can say, hey, man, I just got to give him an Ironman. Heads up, I'll beat him. I get the championship. If you're Ben Kelly, he can't hear me, so I'm not putting any pressure on him, but he has to win this race today.
You know, interestingly, Griff Cotter wrote an article for the 450 words for Racer X Online. If you get a chance to read it, it talks about the historic proportions of what this championship battle is and how the different scenarios could break down coming into this. But did you realize that we have never had a one-point championship ever in GNCC racing? I think the smallest, if I'm not, and you need to go read this, because I think Griff was telling me, is around 9 points or something like that was the closest margin that we've ever had at the very, very end. But the interesting thing is that we are, especially, this is kind of the perfect storm for that. If Stu gets second today and then we go to Ironman, he wins, Ben gets second, then that would mean that he would win the championship. And that would be a historic, a big history-making moment in GNCC racing.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, it's there's so much going on here with the points and things and how they run. You know, but we've seen it this year. We saw at the beginning of the year Grant Baylor with the points lead, Stu's brother. Mm-hmm. Obviously not with us, had a shoulder injury, and I believe there's some other team complications going on as well there. So unfortunately, Grant not with us, not even here this weekend at all. But nonetheless, you know, a great start to the season for him. Soon after, you know, Ben Kelly was able to kind of put the consistency together, grabbed a win in Florida, and got that points lead and has held on to it ever since. Stu just chipping away since missing round one with the infection and then having a clutch issue at round two, only scoring a 14th, so only scoring 7 points. And I'll be the first person to say I wrote Stu Baylor off as a championship contender in that moment. You know, I didn't believe it was possible to come back from that kind of a hole. Well, Stu Baylor, you proved me wrong coming back, putting yourself in the points lead with 2 rounds remaining. And now here we are today with Ben Kelly striking a blow back right now, at least with a 46-second lead. He really wants to have his own destiny going into Ironman in 2 weeks. He doesn't want to need to rely on Stu having a bad race or someone else getting in the mix. He wants to be able to just go out, win the race, and win the championship. And you know Stu Baylor wants the same. So both of these guys want it very badly. Right now, Ben Kelly in the lead into the Monster Mile at the 7 mile marker. And we'll see what the gap is as he jumps out there at 2 hours, 15 minutes, 32 seconds. He jumps out of the coal piles. We'll see what the gap back to the 514 of Stu Baylor. Keep in mind, folks, 46 seconds is what it was when they checked in at the completion of lap number 5, roughly 7 miles ago.
Actually, 48.3. Oh. So, yeah, just I know it's, we're splitting hairs.
No, there. No, you're. I don't know where I came up with 46. I thought we had said 46 seconds, so 48. Hey, if you're knows? Ben Kelly, you don't want to give up those 2.5 seconds. Those could loom large at the end of this one.
They very, very good. Well, could, yes.
I believe I may have seen a little flash of blue there through the woods coming down that hill, meaning Stu Baylor maybe just a few seconds, and there he is popping out. So we were at 32. It's gotten bigger.
47.9 is what I just so it's right at the basically the same gap, about right at 48 seconds is what I got with my clock there. So he really hasn't gained. It hasn't he hasn't relinquished any ground, but this is go time. I mean, 2 hours, 16 minutes into this race, roughly we're going to say around 40 minutes or so left of racing, maybe a little bit more to go for these guys. And it's if Baylor wants to win this, he's got to get the hammer thrown down. But, you know, again, I go back to the mindset, you know, has he just, okay, let's just ride this one out. Let's get to the Ironman and we'll settle it there. I know it's hard to think that he's thinking that, but at the same time, man, Stu does the math himself, and he knows where he's strongest at, and he knows if he doesn't feel so strong here today that he might feel stronger in a couple of weeks in Indiana.
Well, there's no question that I think if you get yourself into that situation after the race, you can settle for that and say, hey, second was good enough today. That's all we needed to do to keep our championship alive. But I think in the moment, I'm not in Stu's helmet any
right.
more than you are, Rodney.
Right.
But I think if I were Stu, I would have a hard time settling for second.
It would be tough.
With still over a lap of racing and knowing that, you know, give credit where credit's due. We have seen Stu Baylor run guys down from gaps much larger than this mm-hmm. in the winning moments of races. We've seen him run down 50-second gaps on the last lap multiple times over the years to grab wins, some of which were against Ben Kelly.
Yes.
So, you know, at this moment, it's still very much possible. But I will say it just doesn't seem like, to you know, use a word the kids use, I don't think Stu Baylor has the sauce today. He hasn't showed it all day long. His speed is great. He's obviously, you know, fit. He's done the work. But something is not the same little spark that Stu has had the last couple races. Ben is on his game. Stu is right there. It definitely was a battle early. Now it's opened up a little bit. But Stu just so far hasn't lit the fuse. Now, with the white flag, we used to talk years ago that the white flag waving was really nothing more than an alarm clock for Chris Borich.
Right.
He would wake up and say, oh, there's a race. White flag? Okay, yep, I'll go win it. And it was true. He did it. I mean, we couldn't even say dozens of times. We would have to say, you know, 40, 50 times.
Yeah.
He would just sit there, and at the white flag, he'd go, oh, okay, I'll go from fifth and go win this thing. It's possible. Stu has done that before, but if he does it today, he's going to need to do it while overcoming a 48-second gap.
Okay, so through the pits, no, I thought he looked like he was going over there just a moment, but it might have been the line drifting him out there. But got him a drink of water. You saw the team over there, but they didn't seem to be any senses of urgency for them at this moment either.
No, and I think, like I said, it could be a situation where, you know, Stu's given it everything he's got, and for one reason or another, he just doesn't have it. Or maybe Ben's just going that fast right now. It's hard to know. He's taking a look over, wants to see where Ben's at. But I will say, if you look at the gap back to Lane Michael, who's riding incredibly well today, we've seen these two, Ben Kelly, Stu Baylor, we've seen them pull minutes on the riders behind them. And right now, you know, it's only a minute 16, at least at the last lap, back to Lane Michael. So I really think, and it could also be, as I mentioned earlier, this track is one you kind of have to take what it gives you. You mm-hmm. can't force it. You can't just go out there and bulldog it. So I think that's why we're seeing the racing be a little bit closer throughout the top 10 in terms of the gaps.
Well, Thad Duval was 14.2 seconds back. He was running about a 4 second faster lap than Lane Michael at the end of lap 5. I would be curious to note to whether or not Thad Duval is closing the gap up on Lane at this particular point. And I'm sure we'll get a chance to see that coming up here in a few moments. But this is, we mentioned, you know, Lane Michael has an address at Boonville, North Carolina, but we know that he grew up here in West Virginia, literally not far from where we are right now. And Thad Duval, a couple of hours from where we are right now as well. Two West Virginia boys basically battling for that final podium spot today, it looks like.
Yeah, and two guys that, you know, really could benefit from the shot in the arm that a podium will give you. We've talked quite a bit at length today, and there is Lane Michael looking like he is still right now holding on to that podium position. Looks like he took a water bottle, dropped it there, And it looks like I see some cheering going on there. Is that Thad? It is.
It is.
Thad Duvall has tracked lane down, and we are going to see
seconds.
A battle for these two over that final podium position here in the final lap. Well, lap plus, they still have 3 miles until they get to the finish line for lap number 5 complete. So a lap and 3 miles. Ben Kelly, quite a bit closer than that. He's about 2 miles ahead of these guys right now. He's at the 10. Those guys are around about the 8. And Ben Kelly inching his way closer. Got about a mile and a quarter until he sees a white flag waving. But there is the battle right there on screen. Lane Michael, the bike you see in front. Thad Duvall, the bike you see there in second. And that is third and fourth as they run here today. And it's going to be a barn burner coming down to the finish between these two, Rodney.
Yeah,
we wait and we watch here. Stu Baylor will be the next rider we see coming through here in second place.
So you're absolutely right. That's going to be that third place position is going to heat up, I think, here in the next. By the time we get to the finish line, I say we're going to see these guys a lot closer. And this is where the battle is going. We're going to watch, I know, but we're going to be keeping an eye as well on what's going on and whether or not Stu is able to bridge any of that gap. And right now it doesn't appear that he's even pushing the envelope right now to even do that. So, like you said, maybe that white flag might be the alarm clock he's looking for.
Could be. The white flag could be what wakes him up, gets him pushing. But at the same time, when we talk about taking what this track will give you, if Stu just doesn't have the sauce, maybe missed the bike setup a little bit, you know, maybe not feeling it, or maybe just recognize the fact, hey, Ben's on his A game today, and I can't win the championship today because mathematically he can't.
Right, but he could lose it.
But he sure could lose it, and that goes for all these guys, you know, or both of these guys. So it would be very smart of Stu Baylor to say, I just don't know if I have it today. We're going to settle in. And is this a new leader in XC2? Looks like Lyndon Snodgrass coming through. Not sure if we missed our leaders, which was Johnny Girard.
I think that was Strang.
Oh, that was Strang.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, that was Josh Strang grabbing a water bottle there. He had the red background on the number plates.
I'm colorblind. That's why I shouldn't.
Well, for someone colorblind, you do a pretty doggone good job.
There we see it looks like Johnny Girard's crew has his water bottle, so he'll be coming here relatively soon, and we'll see how those guys are stacked up there in that XC2 Pro Lights class, because, man, that was a four-way dogfight not too long ago. That's a lapped rider there.
Oh, I thought that was Girard coming through there for a moment.
I think we'll see maybe Ricky Russell still coming through and then the XC2 battle. And there is Johnny Girard. No, that is Ricky. So Ricky Russell. And last we saw, Johnny Girard was in tow just behind him.
Yeah.
But it looks like now Ricky has opened that up just a little bit over your XC2 leader, Johnny Girard. And we may not get to see exactly how that one's going to play out right there.
There he is.
There he is.
So he's not real far. I mean, he's lost a little bit of time there on the XC1 rider. But again, the thing that he needs to worry about is behind him as he leads the XC2 250 Pro class.
And earlier in the year, we heard Johnny talking in interviews and in person. I can tell you he talked a few different times about, you know, being bummed that he was up in a podium position in the overall and, you know, really wanted to be in the top 5 in the podium. And he was frustrated when that wasn't happening. And I think what we've seen lately is, you know, not that Johnny isn't trying his hardest, but he's really focused on winning that XC2 mm-hmm. title, and he's not taking the unnecessary risks that, you know, maybe he had in the past that led to some crashes, some miscues, some some issues that prevented him from being able to complete the final race last year and ultimately battle for that XC2 title with Craig DeLong.
I've seen Johnny Girard after more than one race completely spent and exhausted, barely able to hold his head up. Mountaineer GNCC last year is one that rings a bell specifically as he sat against a wheel of a truck and just and we did the interview from there, if I remember right.
Ben Kelly on screen working his way towards the 11-mile marker, just a few more turns and he will be there. From there, he's just got a couple of chicanes in the woods, pops out, has a little field section, and he'll see a white flag waving. Ricky Towery will be his best friend today, letting him know that he's only got one more circuit around this facility here in Newburgh, West Virginia, and potentially looking at grabbing a win and wrestling back the points lead that he lost just 2 weeks ago to Stuart Baylor.
Well, I know that'll be a very happy KTM team to see that happen. They like the wins, and they like the position of being number one, and that's what they're working on making happen here today. And this, well, the rest of this season and today and one more round. I mean, a lot of work going in. You know, you mentioned teams there a little bit ago as we watched Stu Baylor making his way through now.
you know, you mentioned the team aspect of it, and you know, the excitement in the team and the work that the team is doing to get together. They share it all together, literally.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's you can't do this alone at this level. You know, it takes someone has to get that bike dialed in. You have to have a great mechanic. You have to have a great suspension tech, team owner. You know, the guidance. A lot of these guys have coaches, and you know, a lot of them also have trainers, and these are the guys that kind of keep these guys on task throughout the week. And it takes a village to do this. Ben Kelly, just a few more chicanes, and he will be in with a white flag waving.
You know, just thinking here, Johnny, out loud, you got to wonder, you know, you mentioned the team and the people and the camaraderie that you have together, but you have to wonder the camaraderie that you have between Corey and Stu. Corey McDonald is mechanic. You have to wonder, would Stu have had the same successes without that kind of camaraderie with his mechanic there?
Rodney, we've talked about this a little bit on the show, and I think the reality of it is Stu wouldn't have even had this opportunity at Yamaha were it not for his relationship with Corey. That's my belief. I'm not speaking as factual or as I have any inside information, but I believe that the tight-knit friendship that he had with Corey is what, you know, really kind of opened the door for this opportunity with Yamaha 1 year ago. You know, when he had ridden a couple of different bikes and he was kind of testing some stuff out, and he joked and said, hey, I'm just going to ride a different bike every weekend and I'm not going to sign with anybody. And, you know, Corey just kept pushing the issue and saying, you know, I think we need to let this guy ride one of our bikes. And team owner Randy Hawkins, obviously seeing the talent and the determination of Stu Baylor, couldn't help but be kind of caught up in the moment and say, hey, let's get this guy on a bike. Let's get him out there for one race. And that's all it was. It was a one race deal. It opened the door and, you know, Stu Baylor burst through like the Kool-Aid man. You know,
he
didn't even come through the door. He came through the wall next to the door. He said, hey, thanks for opening the door, but
oh, yeah.
I'm here and oh yeah. And it's been a heck of a run for him. And you know, there's the white flag. So is that going to be Stu Baylor's alarm clock? Are we going to see him make up the gap of,
well, from 48.3 and a 28.37 lap time to a 28.14 lap time, and a gap of 1 minute and now 7 seconds, just under 1 minute and 8 seconds. So it is starting to widen quite a bit.
It's opening up. It's not a bridge too far to cross, but it is a leap. I mean, Stu Baylor is going to have to be full send or look for a little luck this last lap if he wants a chance. Here is our podium battle.
Yeah.
And there it is. Lane Michaels still holding on to third. Thad Duvall just behind him there in fourth. And these guys may be friends off the track, but each one of these guys has been chasing podiums here lately. For Thad Duvall, it's been all year long that he's been trying to grab that podium. And last race, had a great race, coming through with the top five. Thought he was going to be in that podium battle. And today, it looks like he's even closer now with a white flag waving with a very, very realistic shot to land. Oh, Ben Kelly off the track. That same berm where we saw Stu Baylor have the little miscue last lap. Ben Kelly gets deep into that thing, gets a little huckabuck, gets sideways, gets out into the grass. But he's back. Never came off the bike, didn't have a crash, but was off the track into the loamy stuff. And now he's back on track and in pursuit of a win here today.
Well, here's our battle for third coming into the finish line. Chicanes, it looks like, as the 523 of Lane Michael from Fairmont, West Virginia, originally, and, of course, Williamstown, West Virginia's Thad Duvall checking in the fourth place position. The gap, a minute 36 seconds between second and third, but the gap between Lane Michael and Thad Duvall, 1.8 is what it says, 28:33 lap time for Lane Michael, 28:21 lap time for Thad Duvall. And Thad's lap times are not far off that of Stu Baylor's, which was a 28:14. However, Ben Kelly still sub 28 minutes there.
Yeah, Ben Kelly's pouring the coal to it right now. He's doing everything he can to try and widen the gap. And you've got to know what Ben Kelly's thinking is, man, Stu has wrestled these things away from me in every way imaginable so far in 2021. The only way I can make sure that that doesn't happen is if I just absolutely pin it and leave no second unturned. He's sprinting for every second here late in the race and trying to open up that gap. I would assume that if he can get some pit boards here midway through this lap and see that that gap is still over or close to a minute, I think we might start to see him kind of relax a little bit, back off the pace, and kind of play it safe. But right now, there's none of that. He's in full push mode. When it comes to Thad Duvall and Lane Michael, you know, these two have some history as well. If you go back several years, they actually rode for the same team. Thad was the XC1 rider. Lane was the XC2 rider on the Morgantown Honda Morgantown right. Power Sports Honda team. You know, so these two have ridden together. They lived close enough together that they would meet up and ride during the week. They've spent a good bit of time together in the last couple years, or this year specifically, with Thad Duvall now training with Caleb Russell at the Ranch Russell facility. Lane Michael, Caleb's brother-in-law, also training there. So these guys have spent a lot of time measuring each other up during the week, and right now they're measuring each other up for the last podium spot.
It's going to get interesting, I think, and it's great seeing Lane rise to the occasion. I think the championship with the U.S. Sprint Enduro probably is going to give him a little bit of confidence. And the ride that he's putting together today has got to be a bit of confidence as well. I mean, he's got to be feeling – I mean, he's riding it, and the way he's riding, you can tell he feels good right now.
I would venture to guess that this is not only the second time Lane Michael has raced here at CJ Raceway. This might be the only second time that he's been here for the Buckwheat 100 GNCC, but the local series that Lane has frequented over the years, like several different series, the New East Coast and all these others, they have run this property countless times over the last decade, and I would venture to guess that Lane Michael has been here for many of those. So, you know, familiar territory. Thad lives a little further from here. Not saying he's never raced here. He may have, but Thad tends to stick more to the Wexer races and those in Southern Ohio over that direction, because even though he's a West Virginia native, he's kind of closer over that way. So I would say that this might be, you know, the first I don't actually remember if Thad was back in action for this round last year or not, but it's either probably likely the first or second time he's raced here. Here is Johnny Girard coming through. We'll check our screens, but we believe this is your XC2 leader, and he is back behind Ricky Russell, almost as if Ricky Russell's his pace car. And team manager Barry Hawk, who knows a thing or two about winning races and titles, may have said, hey, you know, Ricky's having a rough day. Don't go out there and pass him. You guys just ride together. Keep him out of trouble, and let's go get this championship. But Craig DeLong still back there lurking. We'll see what the gap is when he checks in.
Jonathan Girard checking in on the 969. 28:55 lap time. He's eighth place overall for the moment.
And Craig DeLong just now checking in, Rodney. So there is second place in that XC2 Pro Lights. And again, we did point out that per the gap, I've not done the math myself, but from what I've been told, even if he can pass Johnny Girard, that is not enough to keep the championship hopes alive. He needs a few other riders to get in there as well.
That's right. I understand a fourth or better will win it for Johnny Girard. And of course, we'll find out whether or not he's able to hang on to that. And what's going to happen in this battle for third place between the two West Virginia natives? Thad Duvall, is he going to track down Lane Michael? Stick around to find out. GNCC Live continues after this.
Even when you're the best, you never stop striving to be better. With over 40 years of experience in motorcycle sales and service, we know racing. Our inventory of Yamaha motorcycles, sport bikes, dirt bikes, ATVs, and side-by-sides is extensive and constantly changing. Stop by LoJack Cycle Sales today in Tarentum, Pennsylvania, and visit our online inventory at www.lojacks.com. Yamaha YZs. It's why we ride.
Hi, my name is Andrea Lee, the director of On Track School. How would you like to go to a school where we take into consideration how students learn best? Well, we do that because we find if we can build the curriculum around the things you are interested in, you're going to do a better job. The mission at On Track School is that educational success is possible while chasing your dreams. Not only will our staff help students to achieve success, they will cheer you on to the finish line. We encourage you to check out OnTrack School at OnTrackSchool.com, where we can help you chase your dreams and still get a quality education.
are American motorcyclists. We are members of the American Motorcyclist Association. Racers, fans, and crew, we come together for this sport we love, to race together, to grow together. We start young and not so young. We race motorcycles and ATVs. We become friends, we become family. We compete for weekend bragging rights and national championships. We make memories on the toughest off-road courses in the country and on the best motocross tracks in the world. Some of us aspire to the speed and poise of road racing or the fierce competitiveness of American flat track. And we honor our greatest champions in the AMA Motorcycle Hall of Fame. Through it all, we cheer. We win and we lose. We are racing. We are the AMA. Race with us. Be part of the greatest sport in the world. Be an American motorcyclist. Join us today at www.amajoin.com/join-now.
Brown's RV Superstore is family-owned and operated and stake their reputation on offering you the finest RVs available in their McBee, South Carolina RV dealership. Brown's RV Superstore carries motorhomes, fifth wheels, travel trailers, and toy haulers, and keep a huge inventory of new and used RVs in stock for you to choose from. They offer top dollar for your RV trade-in and help you get the RV financing you need. As a part of the GNCC family, Brown's RV Superstore, in partnership with Vengeance Toy Haulers, offers sponsorship packages for every level of racer with discounts and continued savings on your new toy hauler. Brown's RV Superstore has dedicated themselves to complete customer satisfaction, specializing in providing a positive start to your RV adventure. They look forward to customers coming back to share their tales from the road. Call Brown's RV Superstore today at 877-805-3658 or visit their website at brownsrvsuperstore.com, where family fun begins.
This week in Yamaha history takes us back to October 10th, 2010, and the Powerline Park GNCC in St. Clairsville, Ohio. Riders like Glenn Kearney, Josh String, Charlie Mullins, Barry Hawk, Michael Lafferty, Corey Buttrick, Toby Price, Justin Williamson, Jordan Rose, Jedediah Haynes, Thad Duvall, and Jimmy Jarrett donned the starting line that day. It was the number one of Paul Whibley, though, getting off to the early lead on lap number one in what would seem to be an endless chase for Glenn Kearney, who got off to the second place position. Behind Kearney was the then number two of Josh Strang, followed by the number three of Charlie Mullins and the number nine of Barry Hawk, with a hard-charging Michael Lafferty putting on some pressure as well. As the race wore on, what seemed to be an all Paul Whibley day on lap number three seemed to turn around as Whibley dropped back to the number three position, allowing on that lap for Glenn Kearney to make the pass and move into the lead. It was a short-lived lead, though. By the end of lap number three and heading into lap number four, Paul Whibley had made the pass back on Glenn Kearney to take over the lead, from which he would not relinquish the rest of the day. The rest of the race was battled out between Josh String, Charlie Mullins, Barry Hawk, and Mike Lafferty just to hang on to a top five. But in the end, it was Paul Whibley taking the win at Powerline Park. And that's this week in Yamaha history.
A big celebration for Josh Strang crossing the line there in third. I'm wondering if that may not have been when he wrapped up that championship.
Yeah, that's what I was beginning to think as well. I think that was it, now that you make mention of it. As we check in with last year's race highlights, a look back to 2020, the season finale of this GNCC racing season.
Oh, Jordan Ashburn just hot coming down that hill. He was a whole shot monster on that Kawasaki last year, and he got quite a few this year on the Magna One Lubricants Husqvarna. But last year was Josh Strange's teammate. Thad Duvall was out there because that was him there the second. Stu Baylor, Ben Kelly on the familiar 530 KTM. But Stu Baylor charging, taking the lead away. Jordan Ashburn is second, and Ben Kelly in third.
Almost kind of reminiscent of what we've seen a lot of here in the 2021 season. That's what we were witnessing there in the early part of the race. And here we saw, it looked like Kelly had reeled in Stu Baylor here at this particular point in the race, Johnny.
Yeah, there was a lot of battles. They were back and forth. And it seemed Ben had a little better pace. And then here it is. This is that moto we talked about. Ben Kelly just absolutely sending it through there, squaring Stu up. and taking the lead away. And Stu, I believe, made a comment, something to the effect on the podium after the race. Ben Kelly just absolutely showed me how to be a man through that field. But wild racing action as they work their way towards the finish line.
And who would think a year later nearly it would boil down to a championship battle between those two as they took it all the way to the checkers here. And as we said, the 530 of Ben Kelly crossing the line first, but Craig DeLong actually capturing the XC2 250 Pro Championship on this at this race last year as well.
Yeah, this was the final round last year, so
right.
That championship did come down to this final round, and Craig was able to get the job done, which is why he dons that number one flight on that Rockstar Racing Husqvarna in that XC2 Pro Lights class here in 2021. Now, we're waiting on the leaders here at the 7-mile marker in the Monster Mile, and these coal piles just keep getting rougher and rougher. I can tell you, one lap to the next yesterday, the holes would get deeper, the peaks would get peakier,
yep.
And you really had to commit to just kind of blitz your way through and hop through. And this is one of those situations where I can assure you the camera does no justice. You know, those just kind of look like little hoop-de-doos there. Those are massive holes when you're riding through those things, I can tell you that.
I can only imagine. I mean, and it's funny how they have developed the way that they have developed. But I like the nature. We talked a little bit about this coal pile yesterday being kind of a tribute to West Virginia in itself and the West Virginia coal, which is a major livelihood and has been for many years around this region of the United States. And to be able to put this in like this, I think to me it shows tribute to what West Virginia is all about and what it's built upon.
Yeah, it's a tribute, and also it's a good use of natural resources. They're just sitting around hanging out. We might as well ride some dirt bikes and four-wheelers over them, right?
That's it. It's piled up there. Why not make an it's an obstacle. That's what it is. Still waiting on the leaders here, as this will be their final time through this section of the racetrack. And it was here about a lap ago that we had realized that gap had stretched out to nearly a minute between Stu Baylor. Now minute 24 seconds is what we're getting accounts of between Ben Kelly and Stu Baylor, and there's still about a minute and a half back to that battle for third between Lane Michael and Thad Duvall, which I'm sure a lot of folks are sitting on the edge of their seats about right now in anticipation to see how that one is all going to unfold. As Ben Kelly makes his way now into the coal pile here at the Monster Mile, so he's on track and things are going fairly smoothly, it looks like, for him. And as we said, about a minute and 24 seconds back is when we should anticipate seeing Stu Baylor checking in. But like just mentioning, that minute and 36 seconds, so 3 minutes behind your leader right now is where the battle for the final podium position is underway right now, Johnny. That says a lot about the level at which Ben Kelly's been riding at, you know, and one of the things, and he's even said it in previous interviews and stuff, talking about getting out there and sprinting earlier. I think it was after the John Penton, he'd made the comment, you know, he'd gone out and sprinted a little too early and waxed himself before the end of the race. This today, though, I mean, it was a sprint, but it didn't seem like a full-on sprint. It seemed like a very comfortable cruise that he had going on there, and he just built on it the entire race, and he hasn't waned or slowed down any.
Yeah, no, Ben Kelly's been putting on a clinic today, and, you know, I mentioned earlier, and we've kind of all talked about it, hinted around it, you know, Ben Kelly was not happy after the last round. You know, he was not, he's normally the politically correct poster boy for, you know, put a smile on and thank your sponsors, and that was not the Ben Kelly we saw after the Brokes. Not saying that he did anything inappropriate or wrong, he definitely did not, but he was visibly, I think you believe the word used was frustrated, and that hit the nail on the head. Stu Baylor now through at the 7-mile marker, hopping his way through, and we can see how much intensity there lost there has been for Stu. I don't, again, you know, is it a situation now where he knows he's a minute something back and he's just settled in, still solidly in a second place spot, but Ben Kelly now out almost to, well, at the 8-mile marker, meaning he is one full mile ahead of Stu Baylor. He really just needs to keep it on two wheels to bring this one home at this point. The heroics we were hoping for, the battle we wanted to see this last lap, looking like it's just not at this point going to materialize.
No, it doesn't appear to be the case, as we are somewhere in the near about 8 minutes, less than 10 minutes, 8.5 minutes is what calculated timing and scoring is saying we should see our leaders do in. So with less than 10 minutes to go in this one, unless they're something happens to somebody out there, Ben Kelly and Stu Baylor should be able to run it in that order. But our big question still remains between Lane Michael and Thad Duvall. And again, I'm just going to say it. This has to be probably Lane Michael's best ride, if not best ride ever, best ride in a long time that we've seen for the 523 machine.
Yeah, I mean, we've seen Lane on the podium before in XC1 and overall, but it's been a bit. And, you know, he's had a little rough patch here as of late. He was kind of getting stronger earlier in the year, as you mentioned, and was in that battle for a podium a number of times. Oh, Thad Duvall is through at the 7, so unless we missed Lane Michael, it appears that Thad has now gotten the better of Lane and is in that final.
All right, so word is they got together. Those two riders actually getting together, Lane Michael and Thad Duvall, and Lane Michael goes down, and that was just before they came into the Monster Mile right there, Johnny. So,
and we see Lane Michael missing his right hand guard, so that may be an indication of the contact that was had between the two. Ben Kelly now out, has completed the starting line corners as they ran across the starting line and is now in this final 3 miles. It took him 7 minutes and 30 seconds roughly on lap one, so that's how much racing is left for Ben Kelly and stands between him and his win here today and bringing the points lead back home to the KTM semi at the end of this one. Now, I will say, I can't say for sure, Ben. I know Stu's going to go back and watch this show. I'd like to thank both these guys.
Yeah.
Because this is giving us the ultimate perfect build-up for round 13 at Ironman. And I'll tell you what, folks, if you weren't at Ironman in 2014 when the championship came down between Chris Borch and Walker Fowler on ATVs, I have never seen a crowd for an off-road motorsports event, anything even remotely like that. It was the championship drama. It was the weather was perfect. Everything came together. So everybody, fingers crossed, let's see the same thing, but let's see it on Sunday. Stu Baylor now in VP Fuels Pro Row, because the anticipation, the excitement that weekend was palpable. I've never seen or felt anything like it. The track was lined the whole way around that 12-mile track with people. The pits were like nothing I had ever seen. I mean, there was just tens of thousands of people there to witness that, and I'd like to see that again in 2 weeks when we go to conference.
I believe that we're going to witness that. Honestly, man, with what we've seen and out of that in the history and what the Ironman brings, and with this championship being what it is, this may be the largest crowd we've ever seen hanging on till Sunday at the Ironman.
That track just provides such amazing racing. There's so many lines there. If we get just the perfect amount of dirt, you literally could not find a better dirt for racing anywhere on the planet. So it's exciting. We're 2 weeks away. Folks, mark your calendars. Come out to Crawfordsville, Indiana, 2 weeks from now, 2 weeks from today. There's going to be a championship showdown in the XC1 class on Sunday. Make sure you're there. Don't miss it. And if you can't make it there, please, please make sure you tune into Racer TV, because this one, it's not over, but we're waiting for Ben Kelly here at the 10-mile marker. We should be seeing him here in the next couple moments. And at that point, he'll have about a mile and a quarter. And all that'll stand between him and the finish line is a few little dips and valleys, and he'll bebop his way through those. And if you're a Ben Kelly fan, you're hoping he grabs that win. Thad Duvall, if you're a West Virginia native, if you're a Thad Duvall fan and you're here today, work your way over to the finish line, because as it stands, he is currently in that third and final podium position and working his way towards a checkered flag waving in what I can assure you will be a big celebration for the Rockstar Husky team. This team has had a rough year, and now Thad Duvall looking to bring him home a podium.
Most definitely, and a good ride for him, and still take nothing away from Lane Michaels, who said they got together. Michaels still not real far back. I mean, he's a few seconds back, but when we saw him, he still had a lot of steam in his ride as well. So looking for a great finish out of him, and as frustrating as it's got to be, he's got to be pretty stoked about the ride that he's put forth here today as well. But Ben Kelly right now, 2 hours and 50 minutes into this race, is approaching this finish line, and according to timing and scoring, we should be seeing checkers waving in less than 4 minutes now, Johnny. And I know that, again, until that 4 minutes is up and over and that checker flag flies, there's a lot of folks that aren't going to rest easy, but there's a lot of folks that are standing now with their breath being held, I believe.
Oh, I'm sure. You can guarantee the team members for both of the, you know, all three of those teams, because the Ampro Yamaha team obviously having two guys in the battle
right
there, with Stu Baylor in second and Lane Michael in fourth. Still a potential to get that final podium position, because if you think about it, yesterday we saw a big shakeup about roughly give or take about just after what we're looking at on screen here. Yeah. It was about the 10.5. So those guys not through there yet. That section's a little easier today. It's dried up a bit. Yesterday it was real swampy. And those guys, like you mentioned before with the drone, you can see they just kind of got sucked into the mud there. And there is Stu Baylor at the 10-mile marker, still pushing, still charging, still trying all that he can to make sure he at least gets that second-place position, or should Ben Kelly have a miscue or some kind of a mishap, be able to capitalize on it.
Well, Stu is through at Method Alley, and our third-place ride of Thad Duval should be checking in the next minute or so himself. And, man, like I said, you know, the perfect storm rolling into Indiana. By the way, this will be Ben Kelly's third win of the 2021 season. Just good, consistent season. Obviously, with the first two rounds being, well, subpar for the second round and not able to race that first round. For Stu Baylor, those podiums have certainly added up and kept him up front. There's Jonathan Girard, who looks like he's on his way, I believe, if I'm not mistaken, to the national championship.
Yeah, it'd be a big celebration for the Coastal Racing crew. I know they've been anticipating this. He's been the kind of the class of that field in that XC2 Pro Lights class. There is Craig DeLong, though, still very close, looking to possibly try to wrestle that win away, at least in the final miles. Won't be enough, even if he can get that win, should Johnny finish second, to delay the title through Ironman. Johnny will still celebrate, provided he does make it to the finish line in a top four position. But if you're Craig DeLong, you still want to try and wrestle the win away and at least have it be your day, even if it ends up being Johnny's year.
For sure, for sure. And again, working our way toward the finish line. We're about a minute and 30 seconds out from checker flag now as the crowd gathers around. And in anticipation of Ben Kelly reclaiming the points lead with one round of racing to go and what looks like will be a four-point lead heading into the Ironman GNCC in just 2 weeks.
That's going to be an exciting one.
I know, man. I've been waiting for Ironman. I mean, not because I wanted the season to go by so fast, but because I anticipated that this was the way it was going to come down. And this is the kind of championship.
Are those green plates or are those red? Is that?
That was green.
Okay, so that is Snodgrass just behind Johnny Girard. So actually we missed him. I believe that is Johnny Girard in front, unless that's Ricky Russell. So Johnny Girard has some heat behind him. He's just trying to lock up a championship. And Lyndon Snodgrass putting pressure on him. We didn't even realize he was there.
You're right.
And that, trying to work his way up there and grab his first ever XC2 win for that Babbitt's Online Monster Energy Kawasaki team. And boys, you better stick around the finish line because we got several battles coming in. And one of them is a battle for the win in the XC2 Pro Lights class.
Here comes your leader now, Ben Kelly, making his way through at the 11-mile marker as he inches his way closer to that points lead once again and control heading into the final round of GNCC racing here for 2021. A lot of lap traffic and a lot of distance time-wise back to second place ride of Stu Baylor, nearly a minute and 30 seconds back off the pace, another minute and 30 seconds back behind them is now Thad Duval. And at this point, you almost have to think that Ben is starting to feel the pressure relinquish and that wind starting to sink in, the fact that it is going to happen as he gets closer and closer to Ricky Towery and the waving of those flags. And you have to wonder, does he have his own bit of celebrations up in store as he wheelies past the fans as he celebrates in his own style? Final turns here, and Ben Kelly heading toward the finish line, and the checker flag will take win number three and the points lead back here in the 2021 championship points race. Kelly now back out front in points. Now can Stu Baylor hold on to second and finish this one out, only going to the Ironman 4 points down and the possibility of still winning this championship by one if he were to win and Ben Kelly were to finish second in 2 weeks. Man, what a big sigh of relief. You can see the weight lifted off that shoulder, and that feels good. And you can tell he's pretty stoked about that in his eyes there. They're smiling. his face has probably got that look of, oh, man, I feel like I'm dying. I pushed myself to so many limits. There's that smile we were looking for.
There's the smile we didn't see 2 weeks ago. And Rodney, you know, it's easy to say now you don't want to put these guys in a hole before a race starts or even while the race is going on. But, you know, we can say it. Ben Kelly's back was against the wall today.
Yes.
He absolutely had to win this race if he wanted to control his own destiny going into Ironman, not have to rely on this guy right here, Stu Baylor, having a bad race or another rider getting in between them. That's what, when you're battling for a championship, you just want to control your own destiny. You want to be able to go out, win, or beat the guy that you need to beat and win.
Exactly.
Win your championship. And that's what Ben Kelly did today. Back against the wall, he came out fighting. The prize fight will go on to round 13. Ding, 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 baby.
The final round. In the championship boxing match, 13 rounds or something like that?
I believe it's 10, but I don't know. I'm not a boxer.
Oh, well, it's going to be 13 now.
13 rounds. They're going to change it just because of GNCC.
They should.
Stu Baylor should be crossing the line here in just a few moments. Coming through the final turns, we expect to see him working his way in, and that will be a second-place position. And as you pointed out, Rodney, that will take the points gap back to a four-point lead for Ben Kelly. Here is Stu, just a couple more turns, and that Ampro Yamaha will cross the line, second place on the day. And Stu Baylor did what he needed to do.
Yes.
Obviously, it would have been great to get the win today, give him a little extra points cushion. But second place, same situation as Ben, controls his own destiny. Whichever one of these guys goes out and finishes ahead of the other ultimately wins the championship. That's what it comes down to.
Well, we couldn't have written a better story, that's for sure, when this season started, as we wind this one down here for round 12 in our penultimate round. One more to go, and it will pit those two head-to-head yet again with the rest of our field. And again, a lot of key players rising to some occasions here today at the end of the season, as Thad Duvall works his way toward the finish line in his first podium of 2021, and good to see him back into that podium mode again.
Absolutely. And oh, whoa, Thad Duvall is down in the final turn. Is he pushing the bike? Oh. Okay, no. Wow.
I think he caught that hay bale as well.
It almost looked like, no, he's pushing the bike. He is out of
gas.
Fuel.
Yep.
And he pushes them in dramatic fashion. Thad Duvall pushes the bike across the line to end up third place here and take the final podium position in his home state of West Virginia.
Wow.
Talk about the drama. And that's how close he was to losing it. Lane Michael right there has no idea that just transpired.
No doubt.
But Thad Duvall ran out of gas, went down in that corner. The bike wouldn't fire. Then it did. And then he ends up running the bike across the finish line. Talk about perfect timing. But I think he may have a little chat with whoever calculates the fuel mileage there.
And it might be what saved him the race, too, to be honest with you. If he'd have had to have gassed, maybe he wouldn't have been able to hold on to that position. But the thing about it is, what I like seeing there, not necessarily the fact that Lane Michael took fourth, but what I like seeing about that fourth place is he was shaking his head in disagreement of his finish there. So that means to me that he's got more to offer. There's the number three of Jordan Ashburn as he'll check in and look like round out your top five as this race going 2 hours, 55 minutes, and 12 seconds. And Ben Kelly taking the overall win by 2 minutes and 7 seconds over Stu Baylor. Thad Duvall finishing 51 seconds back in the number three spot and another 27 seconds back to Lane Michael, with Jordan Ashburn another 25 seconds rounding out the top five.
Interesting little interaction there. That guy with the pit board on his back there just came over and fist bumped Thad Duvall over his first podium finish since working under him. The guy's name's Caleb Russell. He's won a few races and a few championships in his day. So pretty cool interaction there. And also, you know, we did report that there was some contact between Lane Michael and Thad Duvall. We saw them shaking hands, kind of telling war stories after, and they both looked to, you know, hey, hard racing is one thing. Sure, probably neither one of them is happy about the contact, but it's racing. They both look perfectly fine, and they'll move on to the next one. Congratulations, Thad Duvall, on your first podium of 2021, and welcome back to the box at GNCC.
Exactly. Welcome back, my friend. It's good to see you. Again, it sets the stage, even though we still got another round of racing, it sets the stage for good things in 2 weeks. But, man, it really fires me up for what's going on in 2022.
The man we see standing in the corner here, it's hard for me to tell which of the Kawasaki mechanics it is. Could be Joey Maurer. I believe it's Joey Maurer. But, ultimately, he's letting these riders know that there is a battle coming. And look at this. Oh, no, that's Josh Strang. Or is it Strang? No, that's Strang.
Yeah, that's
so
Strang.
We've got a battle coming just behind those guys, though. We've got the XC2 battle coming of Johnny Girard and Lyndon Snodgrass, and that will be for the win in XC2. Those guys were literally wheel to wheel when we saw them last. Johnny Girard just needs to get to the finish line in a top four position to lock up the championship. But when you're a racer, you race. I don't see him pulling over and letting Lyndon Snodgrass go to have that win. But Lyndon Snodgrass has all the motivation in the world to want that win. He's been here. This is his second season, yet to land an XC2 win. This guy had a lot of hype coming in. He's a, you know, well-known world-class rider that has competed for ISDE individual overalls and all kinds of stuff. This guy has serious speed and serious talent, and today could be the day that he brings it all to fruition and grabs his first XC2 win. Or will Johnny Girard put the stamp on 2021 with this title by winning the race? We're going to find out in just a matter of moments here, Rodney.
Well, I believe that is Joey standing there. No excitement in his posture just yet. So as soon as we start to see him change his body language a little bit, I don't think we can expect to see those leaders in the XC2. There it is. Pit board is out. Jonathan Girard is out front against Snodgrass, back in the number two spot.
And you got to wonder what that pit board said. There's two turns left. Maybe they were suggesting a line, go wide, square him up, whatever it may be. Here it comes.
And there it is, Jonathan Girard taking the win and what looks like the 2021 250 XC2 Pro Championship.
Right down to the wire. Couldn't have been any closer.
All right, looks like we're about ready to head down to the Specialized Winner's Circle where Mikey Wayne stands by with our winner, Ben Kelly.
Hey, thanks, guys, down here listening to Johnny Girard win. We didn't see it, but by God, we heard it. Hey, I'm here with Ben Kelly. Ben, you're all smiles today, man. You put in the work in these last couple of weeks, and it showed out there today.
Yeah, man, feels good to get the win. Feels like it's been forever. Stu's been killing it, and, yeah, it was another dogfight today. Honestly, I think he got the whole shot, and I didn't have the best jump, but I got into third quick behind Jordan, and we were able to reel Stu back in. Track was gnarly and probably hard to lead that first lap. He went down, and me and Jordan were able to get by him. And, yeah, I got by him shortly thereafter. And, yeah, just kind of charged, rode strong, and just focused on the track myself and not crashing. I've been crashing so much lately just from losing focus. So, yeah, I'm just pumped to stay focused, stay strong. And, yeah, I felt good all day. And stayed off the ground, a few sketchy moments, but that'll happen. And yeah, it feels really good to pull off a win.
To set the stage, as we head into Ironman in a couple of weeks, I heard Johnny Gallagher and Rodney Tomlin talking about it. We have never had two guys this close in points heading into the last round. Where's your head at as you head into that one? It's do or die.
Yeah, it's wild. It's like win or lose, you know. I got to beat him. He's got to beat me to get that championship, so it's going to be another dogfight. I'm sure we're going to be sending it for the win. And I feel like we both like Ironman. Hopefully the dirt's nice and soft like today. I love that stuff. And, yeah, I'm just excited. It's gonna be crazy for sure. But, yeah, just going to do what I did today. You know, try to have fun, but stay focused and go for another win. And hopefully that will give me the championship.
We'll see it in a couple of weeks at Ironman. Rodney, NBA's got Game 7. MLB's got Game 7. GNCC's got Round 13 of Ironman this year.
That's right. And I tell you, they're going to be coming out in droves to watch this one. And they're going to see a show. There's no doubt about it. As Ben Kelly regains the points lead. Stu Baylor, though, still well within this championship points fight. Again, the amazing saga, basically, of what this season has been. From Stu Baylor's standpoint, it is amazing in and of itself. And this second place finish today, another amazing finish. As you can see, Stu is somewhat spent today. He put out the effort, don't think he didn't. And second place is, it was good. It got him right where he needs to be heading into the final round. Mikey?
Hey, down here with Stu Baylor. Stu, you're sitting over here. I can see the wheels turning in your head, man. What's going on?
It's just one of those days. It felt like you know, I really had good speed, and early on I could gain a lot of time, and then just stupid stuff. I kept little mistakes, like unforeseen front end push and end up in a tree, and then had one big crash, and after that was kind of the game changer. It was like, you know, some days you're on the track and everything kind of clicks, everything goes your ways, and other days it just doesn't. Today was one of those days, and it sucks being this close to the championship. You know, I felt like we've had the most dominant year. and, you know, we're not showing it. You know, the had to sit out on round one and failures at round two, and it's eating at you. You know, it's as this winds down, it you start thinking about all the money that it's costing you if you're not winning. So, you know, I hate to say it like that, but we'll be ready for Ironman. You know, I've ridden really well the last few times there, and you know, I think we won that race two of the last three times we've lined up. So we're looking forward to that one. It should be a good one, and we'll have fun either way.
Have fun either way. I like to hear that. Here is Stu Baylor, your second place finisher here today.
Well, you can recognize a little disappointment in Stu Baylor right now, and rightfully so. I'm sure he'd hope for better things to transpose today as far as that was concerned. But again, when you take into consideration and look at this championship series, had Stu raced in round one and still had the lackluster finish in round two, say he would have raced and finished anywhere in the top five, he would be in the points lead right now.
Sure, absolutely. You know, and that's the way why we run these races. You know, it's you can't start giving away championships before the season's over. I think a lot of people, when Stu took the points lead, thought, well, this is it. He's going to run away from here. Will Ben Kelly just punch back? But Stu Baylor has the same opportunity to do the same 2 weeks from now.
Well, it looks like we got a new player with his hat in the ring back for 2022. He certainly shows us his worth here in 2021 at the end of the season.
Rodney, this isn't Thad Duvall.
Oh, isn't it?
This is Bad Thad.
Bad Thad. That's it. Let's head down and get a word in from Bad Thad Duvall.
Bad Thad. That's what they're calling you, dude. You're back. Hey, a third place finish here today in epic finish style, man. Talk us through it.
Yeah, it was good. I got a good jump and was just kind of riding my own race, and I had a huge crash again. I can't stop crashing, but dropped back to like sixth or seventh, and then just was like, man, what are you like? You gonna get on the podium today or what? But yeah, the bike was awesome, so I just put my head down and hammered as hard as I could the last like three laps, and caught lane, and then man, it was a duel. It's funny, you know, he grew up like 30 minutes down the road, and I grew up with him, and I was like, man, what's the odds of two kids battling for last position on the podium right here? Like, just grew up right down the road. So got around him, and then we had a moment over here right before the PowerPoint, I think. We both hit, like, lines came together, and, yeah, it was wild. I think he might have went down and gave me a little cushion to kind of just cruise to the finish, and, right at the end, I had to push my bike across the line and got the heart rate up a little bit, but it was good. It's like a monkey off my back to be finally back up here. It's been a long time, and I feel like I'm starting to be a little bit normal. Just got to be better and be with these guys off the beginning.
There you go, man. A step in the right direction. Congratulations to Thad Duvall, finishing third place here today at the Buckwheat 100.
Well, big day for Thad Duvall, like you said, Bad Thad, and he has made his return triumphantly to at least to a third-place position, and that's saying a lot. And you know, that could make him a player coming ahead, heading over to Ironman with this confidence, knowing where he's at. I mean, again, spoiler. I mean, that makes that championship race even more exciting when we go to head into Ironman GNCC here in just a couple of weeks. Jonathan Girard taking the win in the XC2 250 Pro Class. Lyndon Snodgrass held on for second, 1.3 seconds back. Craig DeLong was 58 seconds back, and as he rounds out the top three, Rui Barbosa, who had ridden a good portion of this race back in the number six spot, finishes up in fourth, and Ryder Lafferty rounds out the top five with Jesse Ansley in sixth and Ben Nelko in seventh with seven. But there he is. I believe it's probably safe to say our new XC2250 Pro National Champion is that guy right there, Jonathan Girard. I know there's a few calculations to do, but Mikey, I'm sure he knows exactly where he stands right now.
Yeah, hey, down here with the XC2 champ, Johnny Girard. Johnny, talk to us, man. Kind of put the season in perspective for us. If you can, you're exhausted per usual. Johnny Girard leaving it all hang out on the track.
Yeah, it was an awesome season. You know, I had a lot of great races and a couple bad ones, but that's racing. And I had to work hard this year, and every race was different. And Lyndon came out of nowhere this last one. I was exhausted. I crashed a lot of times today and made it hard on myself, but the track was gnarly, and you always had to be paying attention or you get caught off guard really easily. So, yeah, it was a good race, like I said, and had to work all the way to the finish.
Well, big congratulations to you, John. Has it sunk in yet, man? You're the champ!
Not yet.
All right, we'll give you a minute. It's going to sink in real soon, though, guys. Make some noise for Johnny Girard.
Man, what a personality Johnny Girard is. There's no doubt about it. I mean, he is your typical Mr. Nice Guy whenever you look at him and you get to talk to him. I mean, you can't help but like him and fall in love with the program that he has and get behind him, so to speak, you know?
Yeah, that's really cool to see Johnny, you know, get that championship. Such a journeyman coming from, you know, up in the Northeast and, you know, came here kind of on his own accord a couple times and raced at Unadilla and some other ones that were close. And then came here and had a little bit of support with had some good support actually with the Obermeyer Suzuki team. The one year came out, got his first podium, and then came back 2 years ago with the Trail Jesters KTM team, won some races, and then had some serious health issues, fought back again. I mean, this guy's a guy that just keeps jumping every hurdle the world throws his way and pays him off with an XC2 title.
Well, Ben Kelly once again takes the win. Stu Baylor in second. Bad Thad Duvall third. Lane Michael, a valiant effort for that rider today. Just saw some video footage of the crash between he and Thad Duvall. They were intensely battling, no doubt. Jordan Ashburn finishing up fifth. Josh Strang in sixth. The Intimidator, Trevor Bollinger, seventh. Jonathan Girard in that number eight spot as he took the win. Lennon Snodgrass in ninth. And Craig DeLong rounds out your top ten. That was first, second, and third in the XC2 250 Pro class in the 8, 9, and 10 spots. So good places and strong finishes for them as well here at the end of this Buckwheat 100 GNCC. What a battle. What a day. And it only rolls on in two more weeks at the Ironman GNCC. Want to see how this season plays out? Who will be champion? Well, we'll find out with you, like we said, in 2 weeks from now. Join us then. On behalf of Johnny Gallagher, Mikey Waynes, and all the entire Racer TV team, I'm Rodney Tomlin. Have a great day, everybody.